Next, a Senate Homeland Security hearing on U.S. northern border threats and security. Border Patrol officials discuss challenges such as unaccompanied minors and illegal immigrants, drug and human trafficking, and terrorism threats. This is 2.5 hours.
Good morning. This hearing will come to order. Senator Carper is on his way, and his staff informed me that we could get underway here. So I would like to, without objection, enter my opening comments into the record. Hearing no objection, so ordered. As I was talking to the witnesses before the hearing here, this is our fifth in a series of four hearings on border security. And what we are trying to do is we're trying to lay out the reality, and I think Senator Brooker would agree with me, it's not a pleasant reality. It's an enormously difficult problem, and of course, in terms of illegal immigration, in terms of drug trafficking, you know, the biggest problem is, no doubt about it, it's on the southern border. As my ranking member says repeatedly, and I completely agree with this, coming from a manufacturing background, we really need to analyze the root cause of the problem. We had an extremely good meeting with General Kelly, head of Southern Command, yesterday, and you know, just discussing the problems in Central America and problems with border security and the drug trafficking. And looking for that root cause, you know, we were discussing, it's really America's demand for drugs. You know, how that demand has, you know, created these drug cartels that have really corroded, been, you know, so harmful to the societies in Central America. You know, we bear some responsibility for that. So these are not going to be easy problems to solve, but we have to make incremental improvements. I come from a manufacturing background. You know, nothing's ever perfect. You always have to continuously improve. So again, the purpose of this hearing and every hearing is to get the people watching, people in the dais here, admitting we have the problem by trying to lay out that reality properly. So I see that our ranking member has joined us here. So I'd like to turn it over if you've got some opening comments.
I'd love to, not too long. Good morning, Warden. Good to come. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for pulling us together. Important hearing, and we appreciate those members, including the senator from New Jersey, who has been very strong in encouraging us to have this kind of hearing. So thank you, Corey. Over the past couple of months, we spent a fair amount of time on this committee, as some of you know, because you've been here, but focus on trying to better understand the security challenges that we face along our southern border with Mexico. But as large and challenging as our southern border is, our shared border with Canada is even larger and comes with its own unique opportunities and risks. Our shared border with Canada is the largest in the world. It spans some 4,000 miles, and when you add in Alaska, Alaska's borders with Canada, it goes up to about 5,500 miles. It's huge. It's also an economic powerhouse for both of our countries. According to at least one estimate, some 300,000 people and $1.5 billion in trade cross the U.S.-Canada border every day. Every day. That's something to celebrate, even as we pay close attention to addressing potential border threats. Last Congress, I had the pleasure of visiting up in Michigan with Senator Levin and North Dakota with Senator Heitkamp. And a memorable visit with that, Carl Levin, memorable visit. Carl and I sat went to this Mexican restaurant. We sat in the parking lot and listened to the opening game in Minnesota. The Tigers beat the Twins. I won't forget that. Great day. The risk along our northern borders include both northbound and southbound flows of drugs, other transnational criminal activity, and potential exploitation by terrorists. Since 9/11, we've increased our border staffing technology footprint along the northern border. For instance, I think there are about 2,000 Border Patrol agents stationed on the northern border today, and that's compared to, I think, 340 in 2001. That's almost a sevenfold increase. And there are about 3,700 CBP officers at the northern ports of entry. That's an increase of about a third over the last 10 years. We now have several CBP drones patrolling high above our northern border as well. Is there more that we can do to better secure our northern border? Sure there is. However, we can no more seal this border than we can totally close our southern border with Mexico. Having said that, we need to better understand the risks associated with it, and then we need to implement the most cost-effective strategy to buy down those risks. And we need to do this while sustaining the robust trade and travel relationships that benefit us and our neighbors so greatly. Not unlike our southern border, force multiplying technology such as aerial surveillance, underground sensors, cameras on mobile towers can greatly increase our ability to detect and respond to threats along this vast northern border. Good intelligence and strong information sharing networks can also help make the best use of limited staffing and resources. Fortunately, our relationship with Canada is perhaps the best force multiplier we could wish for. Canadian and U.S. agents are working closer and closer together in a number of areas to enhance our shared security and ensure our shared prosperity. We look forward to hearing more about how this relationship is working under the 2011 Beyond the Border framework and any other areas of progress is still needed. I also hope the witnesses will address whether there are successful practices at the northern border, either for increasing security or expediting trade or both, that we could replicate and use on our southern border with Mexico. And finally, I continue to hope that our focus on border security will become part of a larger conversation on how to fix our broken immigration system and pass comprehensive immigration reform. And with that, we look forward to your testimony. Thank you all for coming and for your service.
Thank you, Senator Carper. You know, this committee really is pretty well populated with senators from those border states. We've got Senator Peters from Michigan. I'm from Wisconsin. We have Senator Tester in Montana, Senator Heitkamp from North Dakota, Senator Ayotte from New Hampshire. So this really is a pretty relevant hearing. And no, you're welcome as well. It's all part and parcel of the same problem. No, we're actually here. Glad to see you, Mr. Chairman. But again, I do want to welcome the witnesses. You know, thank you for your very thoughtful testimony, and we're really looking forward to your testimony. It is the tradition of this committee to swear in witnesses. So if you all raise your right hand. Do you swear the testimony you will give before this committee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you, God?
Thank you.
Thank you. We by the way, we do have votes starting at 10:45, so I would ask the witnesses to keep your opening statements to the 6-minute time frame so we have time for questions, because we've got good attendance here by our committee. Our first witness is Michael J. Fisher. He's the chief of the U.S. Border Patrol. Chief Fisher joined the U.S. Border Patrol in June 1987 and has served in numerous sectors and positions since then, including field operations supervisor in El Paso, deputy chief patrol agent of the Detroit sector, assistant chief patrol agent in the Tucson sector, and chief patrol agent of the San Diego sector. Mr. Fisher.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Carper, and members of the committee. It is indeed a privilege to appear today on behalf of the United States Border Patrol to discuss our strategy to secure the northern border between the ports of entry. Our approach along the northern border supports U.S. Customs and Border Protection's overarching strategic themes of collaboration, integration, and innovation. Collaboration at all levels, including information sharing and operational coordination among U.S. and Canadian law enforcement, is critical to the shared security of the border. Advanced information and intelligence is and will always be the key to minimizing risk along our borders. For instance, the Operational Integration Center, or the OIC, located at Selfridge Air National Guard Base in Michigan, is an information sharing demonstration project to enhance the situational awareness of CBP and our mission partners, including U.S. Coast Guard, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, state and local law enforcement, as well as the Royal Canadian Mounted Police and the Canadian Border Services Agency. The OIC consolidates a wide range of information, including radar and camera feeds, Blue Force tracking, database queries from databases not previously available to CBP, remote sensor inputs, remote video surveillance and mobile surveillance system feeds, and video from various ports of entry. Additional information feeds, such as local traffic cameras, will be added in the near future. In terms of innovation, our joint efforts to improve existing surveillance technologies that can overcome northern border terrain and environmental challenges, the Department of Homeland Security Science and Technology Directorate is collaborating with Canada, along with us, and a sensor-sharing pilot to demonstrate the capability and operational utility of a common surveillance picture between CBP and the RCMP, using a combination of U.S. and Canadian sensor information. Our situational awareness on the northern border is enhanced by technological capabilities, including thermal camera systems, mobile surveillance systems, and remote video surveillance systems. CBP's Office of Air and Marine has 41 fixed-wing and rotary aircraft equipped with sensors stationed along the northern border, including two unmanned aerial systems, or UASs. And they operate out of the Grand Forks Air Force Base in North Dakota. UAS flights improve our situational awareness and border security in areas that are difficult to reach. In addition, we are expanding the coherent change detection technology along the northern border this year. As this committee is aware, this is the same methodology that allows us to cover approximately 900 miles along the southwest border without having to deploy technology or Border Patrol agents. Finally, our integration efforts continue as well. For instance, each month, CBP produces the State of the Northern Border Briefing, which provides a cross-component, multi-agency intelligence report for identifying, monitoring, and addressing emerging trends and threats along the northern border. The report is produced in direct collaboration with our Canadian partners, as well as other federal, state, and local partners. The State of the Northern Border has provided a broader avenue for information sharing and greater intelligence insight to activity with a nexus along our northern border. The Border Patrol is also an active participant in several targeted joint operations, which are called the Integrated Border Enforcement Teams, or IBETs. They are comprised of U.S. and Canadian law enforcement personnel, encompassing 15 regions along the northern border. IBETs operate as intelligence-driven information teams designed to increase information and intelligence sharing capabilities among the appropriate U.S. and Canadian authorities. By incorporating integrated mobile response capabilities in the air, land, and the marine environments, the IBETs provide participating law enforcement agencies with a force multiplier that maximizes border enforcement efforts. Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Carper, again, thank you for the opportunity to appear today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Chief Fisher. I do want to note that the Deputy Assistant Commissioner of the Office of Field Operations, John Wagner, that was also your written statement, but let me just introduce you as well. You've been assigned to the CBP headquarters since 1999. Mr. Wagner began his federal law enforcement career in 1991 when he joined the U.S. Customs Service as a customs inspector. Mr. Wagner also has worked at the New York, New Jersey Seaport and the Port of Laredo, Texas. So again, appreciate you joining us here and look forward to your answer to questions. Our next witness will be James Sparrow. He's a special agent in charge for the Buffalo, New York area. Mr. Sparrow also served as the Deputy Assistant Director of the ICE Transnational Crime and Public Safety Division, Unit Chief for the Identity and Benefit Fraud Unit at ICE headquarters, and Acting Assistant Special Agent in charge for HSI, their Washington Field Office. By the way, am I pronouncing that right, Mr. Sparrow? Or Spiro?
Yes, Senator, Spiro.
Spiro, okay. Mr. Spiro.
Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Carper, and distinguished members. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you to discuss ICE's efforts to improve security along the northern border. As DHS's principal investigative agency, Homeland Security Investigations is positioned to leverage its broad statutory authority to support border enforcement. HSI works in close coordination with DHS components and U.S. interagency partners, as well as our counterparts in Canadian law enforcement, to target transnational criminal organizations involved in illicit travel, trade, and finance. HSI applies a full range of innovative investigative and enforcement techniques, including leading and participating in joint U.S.-Canadian task forces, undercover operations, controlled deliveries, asset identification and removal, confidential informants, and Title III electronic intercepts to identify and disrupt criminal operations. We have nearly 1,300 special agents and 100 intelligence research specialists operating along the northern border. In fiscal year 2014, HSI's seven special agent in charge offices covering the northern border, often in joint or cooperative investigations with federal, state, local, tribal, and Canadian law enforcement seized more than $237 million in cash and monetary instruments, nearly 26,000 pounds of marijuana, 2,000 pounds of cocaine, 146 pounds of ecstasy, 719 pounds of heroin, 949 pounds of methamphetamine, nearly 1,400 weapons and firearms, over 55,000 rounds of ammunition, and about 8,400 weapon components. HSI special agents made over 5,700 criminal arrests, resulting in nearly 3,800 indictments and approximately 3,500 convictions. These statistics reflect the impact of our coordinated law enforcement investments and investigations along the northern border. Additionally, HSI maintains the largest investigative footprint of any U.S. law enforcement agency in Canada. HSI attaché offices located in Ottawa, Vancouver, Toronto, and Montreal further enhance national security by serving as ICE's liaison to our interagency partners and our counterparts in local government and law enforcement. Our partnerships are essential to joint operations and information sharing along the northern border and beyond. One example is how HSI participates in the FBI-led Joint Terrorism Task Force. HSI brings its unique authorities and experience to the task force to help protect the homeland from threats to national security. HSI's flagship task force program, the Border Enforcement Security Task Force, or BES, created in 2005 as a mechanism to address the threat of cross-border crime. In 2007, ICE began to deploy BES units along the northern border. BES provides a proven and flexible platform from which DHS investigates and targets transnational criminal organizations that attempt to exploit perceived vulnerabilities at our nation's borders. BES units differ from other task forces due to their proximity to the border and the program's focus on cross-border criminal activity. Currently, there are four BES units operating along the northern border. One significant advantage of the BES task force model is the participation and integration of foreign law enforcement personnel who have the ability to conduct cross-border investigations with HSI and our federal, state, local, and tribal partners to address criminal activity on both sides of the border. One successful collaboration with our international law enforcement partners is Operation Primed, which is an HSI Buffalo investigation that targeted a cocaine smuggling organization involved in the illicit movement of cocaine and bulk cash within Canada, the United States, and Mexico. Investigators estimated that this organization was responsible for the smuggling of approximately 1,600 kilograms of cocaine into Canada, with a street value of over $60 million. Through successful collaboration with Canadian law enforcement, a high-level target was sentenced in May of 2014 to 84 months of incarceration. This individual was arrested in September 2010 when attempting to export 97 kilograms of cocaine across the Lewiston Bridge port of entry from New York into Canada. The 97 kilograms of cocaine seizure is to this day the largest seizure in the history of the Port of Buffalo. In conclusion, ICE remains dedicated and committed to this mission, and we look forward to continuing to work with this committee on these efforts. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today, and I would be pleased to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Spiro. I have been informed that Mr. Wagner does have an opening statement. Would you like to give that now, or would you like to wait till the very end?
I thought I was off the hook.
Oh, no. Okay. Would you like to give it now, or would you like to?
I'll give it now, if that's okay.
Okay, sure. Mr. Wagner.
Thank you. Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Carper, and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to appear today on behalf of CBP's Office of Field Operations to discuss our security and facilitation efforts at ports of entry along our northern border. The U.S. international boundary with Canada delineates two friendly nations with a long history of social, cultural, and economic ties that have contributed to a high volume of cross-border trade and travel, amounting to $2 billion a day. CBP ensures that our northern border operations protect and secure the vital flow of commerce through trade and travel between our two countries. The U.S. and Canada are connected by more than 120 land ports of entry, 750 daily flights by commercial aircraft, and numerous commercial and recreational vessels that cross the maritime border. Ensuring the security and efficient flow of cross-border activity, CBP has more than 3,600 CBP officers and 190 agriculture specialists stationed on the border, ensuring dangerous goods, contraband, and individuals are intercepted and legitimate travelers and cargo are expedited. At many northern border ports of entry, we continue to invest in and deploy radio frequency identification technology. This technology, along with the 2009 implementation of the Western Hemisphere Travel Initiative, which requires a passport or other secure document to enter the United States, allows CBP to query nearly 100% of travelers against law enforcement and terrorist screening databases. We also continue to deploy next-generation license plate readers, large-scale and small-scale imaging technology, as well as a variety of portable and handheld technology, including radiation portal monitors. Additionally, DHS and Canadian agencies are collaborating to develop, advance, operationally test, and use technologies to enhance cross-border operations. As part of this effort, we've also made significant investments in infrastructure. Since February 2009, the U.S. government has invested over $400 million to rebuild and improve more than 30 ports of entry along the northern border. Our northern ports of entry experience a very high volume of international trade and travel. Each year, approximately 72 million travelers enter the United States through the border with Canada for business, tourism, school, and to visit family and friends. Many of our initiatives to facilitate lawful international travel at the northern border simultaneously increase security. Likewise, CBP develops effective and efficient security operations designed to be contributors to travel facilitation, not barriers. Security measures vitally protect travel and tourism from the damaging effects of terrorists and other security incidents. Identifying and separating low-risk travelers from those who may require additional scrutiny is a key element in our efforts to facilitate and secure international travel. The volume of trade crossing the northern border is equally significant. In 2014, the combined two-way trade and investment between the U.S. and Canada totaled $759 billion. The U.S. and Canada are each other's largest export market, with roughly 16% of all U.S. exports destined to Canada. CBP is committed to a coordinated approach, working with our federal, private sector, and Canadian partners to facilitate the secure flow of trade and travel, reduce transaction costs, and promote economic growth along the northern border. In 2011, the U.S. and Canada signed the Beyond the Border Initiative. CBP is a primary lead on 15 of the Beyond the Border initiatives and has significant interest and participates in seven others. I'd like to highlight just a few of our accomplishments to date. We've completed the first two phases of the entry-exit pilot, which involves an exchange of entry records of travelers at ports of entry along the U.S.-Canadian border in such manner that land entries into one country will serve as the exit record from another. We've launched a cargo pre-inspection pilot to test the feasibility of conducting primary cargo processing in Canada to reduce wait times and congestions. Phase one of the pilot was completed in Blaine, Washington, in Surrey, British Columbia. Phase two at the Priest Bridge between Buffalo and Fort Erie, Ontario, also recently concluded. In March 16th, DHS concluded negotiations of a new preclearance agreement for land, rail, marine, and air modes of travel. We've also expanded the Nexus Trusted Traveler program to over 1.1 million travelers, an increase of approximately 80% since 2011. Canada and the United States are striving to provide a secure and trusted global supply chain that allows for safe, timely, economically prosperous movement of cargo into and between the two countries. A key means of achieving this objective is through the Integrated Cargo Security Strategy, which seeks to address risks at the earliest opportunity. We conducted pilots in Prince Rupert and Montreal, testing the ability to use advanced data and adopt common standards for security screening and inspecting inbound marine cargo at the first point of arrival in North America. Canada and the United States continue to align and harmonize their Tier 1 Trusted Trader programs. In Canada, the Partners in Protection program, and in the U.S., the Customs Trade Partnership Against Terrorism, the CTPAT program. We're expecting to launch a fully automated harmonization process, allowing a joint application for the cross-border highway carriers in the PIP and CTPAT programs by fall of this year. And this will allow companies interested in joining both programs to submit a single application and to manage only one partnership account instead of two. We've also engaged with local entities and authorities to increase security through public-private partnerships. For example, CBP and the DHS Domestic Nuclear Detection Office have partnered with Buffalo and the Fort Erie Public Bridge Authority to replace 18 radiation portal monitors at the CBP primary inspection lanes in northern New York. This agreement was reached in November of 2014 and was just recently completed. The enhancements will increase security and efficiency by supporting new calibration procedures that will reduce radiation nuisance alarm rates by over 50%. Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Carper, members of the committee, thank you again for the opportunity to testify today, and I'm happy to answer any of your questions.
Thank you, Deputy Commissioner. Our next witness is David Rodriguez. Mr. Rodriguez began his career with the U.S. Customs Service in 1970. From 1973 to 1997, Mr. Rodriguez worked at the DEA. In 1997, he was selected as the director for the Northwest Highway Intensity Drug Trafficking Area Program in Seattle, Washington. In 2010, the NWHIDTA, man, you get used to acronyms in this business, received national awards for its interdiction program and on the U.S. Canada border. Mr. Rodriguez.
Chairman Johnson, distinguished members of the committee, my name is Dave Rodriguez from Seattle, Washington. We coordinate and do joint operations with more than 115 international, federal, local, and state agencies throughout the Northwest. We help these agencies to identify drug threats as well as to implement strategies to address them. The transnational criminal organizations operating on both sides of the U.S.-Canada border continue to move proceeds from illegal drugs sold in the U.S. and Canada, as well as drugs, weapons, and bulk cash. These organizations include Caucasian groups, ethnic East Indians, Asian organized crime groups, and members of the Hells Angels Motorcycle Club. Also of prominence are the Mexican national drug trafficking organizations, particularly those headed by consolidated priority organization targets, who have gained a strong foothold in the Pacific Northwest. These include, but are not limited to, the Sinaloa Cartel, the Knights Templar, and the Beltran Leyva organizations. Washington's topography and location render it susceptible to drug smuggling and production. The Washington sector of the U.S. border is approximately 430 miles long, with 13 official ports of entry. A significant portion of the international border is included dense forest. Remote expanses of public lands are susceptible to many types of drug-related criminal activities, and particularly to large-scale cannabis cultivation. Public lands that are adjacent to the U.S.-Canada border also serve as routes for drug and currency smuggling. Most of the area on both sides of the U.S.-Canada border is sparsely populated and encompassed by densely forested public lands, where crossing the border can be accomplished without detection. Other threats to the U.S. northern border include illegal alien entry, human trafficking, money laundering, firearms trafficking, maritime and air smuggling, and threats relating to terrorist activities. The I-5 corridor is the main transportation route into the Pacific Northwest and into the British Columbia, Canada. Multi-agency investigation shows that DTOs continue to exploit the remote areas along the Washington border, often throwing just duffel bags or hockey bags containing drugs directly across the border. In some areas, we just have a ditch that separates the U.S. and the Canadian parts of their territories. DTOs and transnational criminal organizations in the eastern region of the state take advantage of the remote areas of the border, the lack of cross-border detection equipment, such as radar, and the lack of critical infrastructure, cell towers, to increase the use of these rural routes. Narcotics are often concealed in legitimate cargo on board commercial trucks, cars, concealed truck compartments, and in commercial and private trailers. Helicopters, airplanes, and boats are used to smuggle drug loads into and out of Canada. While cocaine and marijuana seizures along the northern border and Idaho declined in 2014 compared to previous years, there was a demonstrated increase in the quantity and frequency of methamphetamine loads being smuggled into British Columbia. MDMA seizures totaled over 48 kilograms in 2014. MDMA or ecstasy smuggling from British Columbia to Washington State will continue, as Canada is a primary source of MDMA in North America. The precursors are smuggled from China into Canada, where it is processed. Trafficking of MDMA in tablet form remains a standard. However, recent investigations in the Northwest indicate that MDMA is also being smuggled in powdered form. Cocaine continues to be smuggled north into Canada, but seizures have been on the decline. 101 kilograms were seized in the northern border in the state of Washington, compared to over 800 kilograms that were seized in 2008 and 2009. Shipments are also known to be sent directly to Canada from areas outside the U.S. via air and maritime conveyances. Bulk cash seizures in 2013 totaled $3.1 million, and the year before it was less than half a million. In 2014, it was approximately a million, demonstrating the fluctuations seen in bulk cash seizures year to year. Our efforts are guided by the 2012 National Northern Border Counter-Narcotics Strategy, updated in 2014, which articulates the U.S. framework for the ongoing effort to reduce the threats on both sides of the border. The strategy addresses joint efforts in the areas of intelligence collection, information sharing, interdiction at and between ports of entry, as well as in the air and maritime domains, investigations and prosecutions, disrupting and dismantling drug trafficking organizations. Northwest HIDA participates fully in the Northern Border programs and will continue to foster cooperation among federal, state, local, tribal, and international law enforcement agencies along the Washington-British Columbia border. We also believe we share and participate in an important role in both the intel sharing and the enforcement initiatives, training, interdiction, and analytical support. To conclude, I would like to thank you for the opportunity to be able to testify here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rodriguez. Our next witness is Richard Hartunian. Mr. Hartunian is the U.S. Attorney for the Northern District of New York, which covers 300 miles of the U.S.-Canada border. Mr. Hartunian sits on the Attorney General's Advisory Committee, where he serves as the co-chair of the Border and Immigration Subcommittee, in which he leads the Northern Border Working Group. Prior to this, he served as the Assistant U.S. Attorney and as the Northern District's Narcotics Chief and Organized Crime Drug Enforcement Task Force Coordinator. Mr. Hartunian.
Sorry, thank you. The U.S. attorneys for the 16 federal judicial districts along the northern border know well that border security is a critical component of our national security and work with federal, state, local, and tribal law enforcement agencies and our Canadian counterparts to combat the transnational crime that threatens it. The four districts with the largest volume of border crossings and significant border-related criminal activity are Western Washington, Eastern Michigan, Western New York, and my district. The Northern District of New York shares a 310-mile international border with Canada and includes 8 of New York's 11 ports of entry. A huge volume of people and goods pass through the Northern District from the major population centers of Eastern Canada by road, rail, forest, field, and waterway. The territory of the St. Regis Mohawk Tribe, or Akwesasne, straddles the border with portions in New York, Ontario, and Quebec. Smugglers exploit the circumstances at Akwesasne in the Seaway and the large rural areas to cross the border surreptitiously. All along the line, criminal organizations try to take advantage of the nature of the border, the volume of traffic, the binational commitment to accelerate the legitimate flow of trade and travel, and jurisdictional divisions. The prevention of terrorism remains, of course, our number one priority. My family and I have personally felt the impact of terrorism, having lost my 21-year-old sister, Lynn, in the skies over Lockerbie in the December 1988 bombing of Pan Am 103. The terrorist threat is current and real, as dramatically illustrated by the Canadian convictions last month of two men of conspiracy to murder for the benefit of a terrorist group. They plotted to derail a passenger train traveling between New York and Toronto, but were thwarted by a joint investigation that included undercover work by an FBI agent. U.S. Attorney's offices work closely with the 12 joint terrorism task forces operating at and beyond the border and their Canadian counterparts to spot and stop terrorism, understanding that our vigorous enforcement of the federal criminal code prosecuting human traffickers, child exploiters, and those who smuggle drugs, guns, illegal immigrants, and cash reduces the threat of another attack. Our national effort to combat transnational crime includes initiatives promoting coordination and collaboration, such as the integrated border enforcement teams, the Border Enforcement Security Task Forces, and ShipRider, all led by DHS and DEA-led drug task forces. Each of the four busiest districts has a BEST, and ShipRider is expanding eastward after establishing regular operations on the maritime borders in Washington and Michigan. Drug organizations use boats, helicopters, snowmobiles, and vehicle compartments to cross the border without detection of their illicit cargo, ecstasy or high-potency marijuana moving south, and cocaine, firearms, and cash moving north. For example, in northern New York, we recently dismantled a ring that regularly transported hockey bags filled with 100 to 250 pounds of Canadian marijuana across the seaway through Akwesasne for distribution in the Northeast and seized 16 handguns headed for Canada. Another group we dismantled obtained ecstasy in Montreal and regularly delivered 50,000 pills to wholesalers in New York and Boston, returning with cash and several kilos of cocaine. In the fight against human trafficking, a joint investigation by RCMP and HSI into the smuggling of young Romanian women through the U.S. to Montreal for prostitution recently resulted in charges in Canada and the U.S. We cooperate to combat child exploitation, like the case where a defendant was charged in Canada when he tried to bring in child pornography but did not show up for trial. So we took the case, and the defendant was convicted and sentenced to imprisonment for 225 months for transporting nearly 4,000 images and over 100 videos of graphic child pornography. As these cases illustrate, the existing enforcement teams and task forces have had significant successes, but their structure, composition, and mandates have left them short of true integration. The Beyond the Border Declaration in 2011 included the commitment to build on existing bilateral law enforcement programs to develop the next generation of integrated cross-border law enforcement operations. With our Canadian counterparts, we're addressing the issues associated with integrated enforcement. Meanwhile, the vital work of advancing border security goes on and now includes the Border Operations Leadership Team, known as BOLT, which brings together operational leaders from law enforcement and prosecution agencies with border missions for their insights and action on measures to enhance our efforts to eradicate cross-border crime. We're confident that our bilateral commitment to border security, our mutual respect for national sovereignty, and our shared tradition of protecting both public safety and individual rights will strengthen our efforts to achieve more integrated cross-border enforcement. We're committed to continued vigilance using the full range of investigative tools and laws available to us. With BOLT's operational charge, the Northern Border U.S. Attorneys and federal law enforcement agencies are poised to capitalize on the historic opportunity to forge bonds with our Canadian counterparts that increase our effectiveness. Thank you for the opportunity to describe for you the challenges we are facing in the Northern Border. I look forward to answering your questions. Thank you.
And thank you, Mr. Hart and Ian. Thank all the witnesses for your testimony. Certainly one of the purposes of this hearing is to try and get some sense for, you know, where our main problems occur. We have limited resources, so we have the southern borders, we have the maritime borders, we have the northern border. So I'd like to go to you, Chief Fisher, and first just talk about, in general, the basic extent of the problems. The stats I have is that on the southwest border, we had 480,000 apprehensions of people crossing this country illegally. In the northern border, a little over 3,000. Obviously we have a much larger border. The bigger problem in terms of illegal immigration is coming through the southern border. In testimony, we've had contradictory testimony on this. That apprehension, according to the Customs and Border Patrol, is about 75% is what we believe we're apprehending. We've had some CBP agents say it's somewhere between 30 and 40. Again, I realize it's very difficult to get that number. Do we have some sense of what the apprehension rate is on the northern border?
Mr. Chairman, the effectiveness rate is primarily used on the southern border because at that point along the southern border years ago, we have defined the threat, among other things, as flows of people. On the northern border, that's not necessarily the case. The threat is defined in different ways. So using an effectiveness rate like we do on the southern border to the northern border really doesn't make a lot of sense to us. What we do when we take a look at our strategy and looking to where we should deploy our finite resources, we looked a few years ago, and if you take a look at approximately 90% of the Canadian population lives within 100 air miles of the border, and then you take that 4,000 miles and look where the density of population areas are, where transnational criminal organizations and potential people seeking entry between the ports of entry need to operate, it's very concentrated in some of those areas. Our resourcing deployments and redeployments try to match those areas, and it's driven primarily by intelligence.
Okay, but again, is your sense that we really do apprehend a higher percentage on the northern border versus the southern border, or less? I mean, again, I'd ask anybody else who'd want to chime in on that one.
We don't measure that in terms of the effectiveness rate, sir. My sense would be it is at or higher than the southern border, primarily because of the flow rate is so low.
What about in terms of drug trafficking? Do we have any statistics in terms of the total number of tons coming from the southern border versus the drugs being trafficked through the northern border? Is it 10%? Is it 5%?
I don't have the percentage off the top of my head, Mr. Chairman, but I will tell you it's considerably less in terms of the smuggling that occurs between the ports of entry on the northern border than what we see on the southern border.
You know, again, we've had testimony from General McCaffrey, for example, on the southern border, estimate somewhere between 5 to 10% of all drugs are interdicted, which means, you know, 90 to 95% are getting through. Would we have a similar type of interdiction rate on the northern border? Anybody want to answer that might have some sense of that? Or do we simply not know?
Mr. Chairman, I'm not familiar with the General's methodology on that. Generally, when we look at seizure rates along the northern border versus the southern border, we don't measure that in terms of the comparison to differentiate threat.
In terms of the drugs that are flowing through, we've had, again, contradictory testimony on the southern border. We've had one witness saying that the majority of those drugs flow through the actual ports of entry. Other witnesses say that, no, they go around the ports of entry. Do we have any sense on the northern border where the primary drug trafficking is occurring? Are they coming smuggled literally through the ports of entry in lack of detection, or are they coming through, you know, the vast, unmonitored parts of the border? Anybody want to answer trying that one? Mr. Spiro.
Yes, Senator. One of the things that I would say about the flow of drugs on the northern border is it's certainly bi-directional. So certain drugs are coming in from Canada, certain types of drugs are still coming in from Canada, and other drugs are being exported from the U.S. and going from the U.S. into Canada. As far as the difference between whether or not we're making investigations at drugs being interdicted either at the port of entry or between the ports, we're seeing both, just in some cases different drugs. The case that I spoke about on my during my oral statement was a case where the tractor trailer that was being used by the drug smuggling organization to get cocaine from the Ontario, California part where the drugs were being stored at the warehouse, was actually being transported through across the U.S. and through the Port of Buffalo, and were supposed to be delivered to Canada. That particular method was in a trap or a concealed compartment. It was actually under the floorboards of the tractor trailer. That particular delivery been successful, that would have been a case of drug smuggling going into Canada through the ports of entry. But likewise, you know, we still see, smuggling. I believe it was Mr. Hartunian and Mr. Rodriguez who were talking about the hockey bags coming across in between the ports, whether those are hockey bags of marijuana or some other kind of drug. We get referrals from both the Border Patrol, who make those interdictions between the ports, as well as we do from the Office of Field Operation, who are making those interdictions at the ports. So we're seeing a mix from Homeland Security investigations, sir.
You know, one huge difference between the borders, you know, south versus north, is the cooperation of the bordering country. And we obviously have far greater cooperation between U.S. and Canada than we have with U.S. and Mexico, which makes our job a whole lot easier. We did On March 16, 2015, we've entered into or signed an agreement on land, rail, marine, and air transport pre-clearance, which is going to require legislation on both sides of the border here. But Chief Fisher, can you just speak to the difference between the cooperation we have with the Mexican government versus the cooperation we have with the Canadian difference, and how what an enormous difference that makes?
Well, information for us is the key to be able to reduce any vulnerabilities, regardless of what border we're talking about. And in particular with Canada, what we have found over the years is the information sharing is really good. It gets better. I have the opportunity to have three Border Patrol agents that are embedded with the RCMP in Canada, with a fourth to come along shortly this year. And having a Border Patrol agent in Canada working with the RCMP only bolsters our ability to understand the evolving threats and helps us secure the border on both sides.
So that type of model, you know, that we have with Canada, if we could implement something similar in Mexico, would make a tremendous difference?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, it would.
Okay. Thanks, Chief Fisher. Senator Carper.
I think the question the chairman raised is just really important one, really important one. And to the extent that we can grow, strengthen our relationship with Mexico, improve our confidence in the information that they can provide them and that they can provide us, will only help. I think it could be maybe one of the best force multipliers on the Canadian border is our relationship with Canada. And I want to just dwell on force multipliers for a while. At least one of you, maybe a couple of you, in talking about force multipliers, mentioned the assets that we're able to deploy between the ports of entry. We have drones on the border with Mexico. We have drones, a couple at least, up on our border with Canada. We have fixed-wing aircraft down along our border with Mexico. We have fixed-wing aircraft up along our border with Mexico. What we find out, we had an Inspector General's report come out a couple of months ago and raised some real serious questions about the efficiency, the effectiveness of the drones that we're using on our southern border. They already have problems. We know that if the wind is a certain above a certain velocity, they can't fly, they can't operate, and certain kinds of weather, they can't operate. They haven't always had Vader systems on board, which make them far more effective in terms of sensory platform. We saw some aircraft used along the Mexican border, that fixed-wing aircraft that we just sent them out with binoculars, as opposed to having something like a Vader system on board. Let's talk just about how effective some of those force multipliers are. Not so much along the southern border, but let's talk about how effective they are on the northern border, and what can we do to make sure that they're even more effective. The question, I don't know that we need to add a whole lot of people. We've added a lot of people on the northern border. We've certainly added a lot of people on the southern border. What we need to do is be able to deploy them more effectively.
Senator, you raise a really interesting point and very important point in terms of our strategy along the northern border. You're right. A lot of times people look at the northern border deployments with an eye towards the south and say, how come you're not deploying that way? I will tell you in terms of technology, whether it's handheld sensing equipment, unattended ground sensors, remote video surveillance systems, the type of technology that we deploy along the northern or the southern border is the same along the northern border. Our enforcement posture and response to some of those tips and cues may be different. However, our ability to increase that situational awareness is the same in terms of our strategy and the implementation. What is, at least for us, very exciting on the northern border, because of the vast terrain, because of the remoteness in some of these locations and our inability to access the immediate border, whether it's because of lack of infrastructure or roads or because of the impediments in which the terrain provides. We have, and we'll start this year, the collection effort that we're doing along the southern border, which in fact we started back in March of 2013, and utilizing the unmanned aerial systems, utilizing additional Vader technology and synthetic aperture radar, we have targeted over this past year about 80% of the northern border from the field chiefs identifying those very remote locations for us to start doing collection against those areas to be able to do a before and after picture. And so think of it in terms of a 30-mile stretch along the northern border. And the unmanned aerial system will go out and deploy, and it will take a series of videos along those remote areas. 24 hours later, that unmanned aerial system, along with the same technology, will do the same flight. Now, those before and after videos will then be sent into a computer at what we call a processing, exploitation, and dissemination cell. And there, very smart and very talented analysts will take a look and see if there's been any change, incursions, if you will, across that border from the first picture to the next picture. That gives us a sense on whether or not, one, we have incursions, two, whether those areas are emerging threats, or equally important, what we find along the southern border, areas where there is no activity for a variety of reasons, which tells us, which is equally important, we're not to deploy technology and Border Patrol agents so that we can focus on those areas that we know, based on intelligence, based on experience, on where those crossings are more likely to occur.
Okay. Well, we were talking earlier in my opening statement, I mentioned that we have a 4,000-mile border with Canada, plus another 1,500 miles with Alaska in Canada, 5,500 miles. Any idea how many drones we have up here?
We currently have approximately 9 unmanned aerial systems within the CBP inventory. There are currently 2 that are assigned to North Dakota. That doesn't necessarily mean we can only fly 2 there. We do what's called federated flights, so we can move those unmanned aerial systems from the northern border to the southern border based on identified threats. And because of the capability to run federated queries, we also have, through the FAA, the certificates of authorization to be able to move across from the northern to the southern border based on threats.
So at any given day, we might have 2 or 3, 4 drones along the border with Canada. Does that sound about right?
Primarily, it would be 2. In the event we needed to plus that up for a variety of reasons, we would be able to augment that.
Mm-hmm. And how often do we have them up in the air?
That I don't know, sir. Again, as you indicated, weather permitting, just like any other manned system, whether it's a helicopter or a fixed wing, the weather is going to be a limiting factor and the readiness rate on when those can fly.
Okay. I'm going to ask you to answer that for the record.
I will do that.
If
yes,
you would,
Senator.
Please. Well, let me ask each of you, just starting with you, Mr. Artunian, giving us good advice, what should we be doing more of in our roles that will be helpful to you in the work that you do? And I must say I'm very impressed by the work that you're all doing. But just give us some for the legislative body here. We're going to be taking up appropriations very soon. Anything that you would especially bring to our attention that could be helpful?
Well, Senator, thank you for that question, which is important. The first thing I think you're doing, which is to call attention to the northern border, and we're grateful for the committee's attention on this issue. There are a lot of challenges we face up there, but as you could tell, I think we're doing some good work. We have great geographic challenges, a lot of big space. But, you know, as I think about some of the things that could be helpful to us in our work with the Canadians, we've had great challenges that have come about in recent years as a result of the explosion of requests for information, formally the MLAT requests. And we're seeing more and more of those. Information in investigations is frequently needed from computer systems and emails. And while we're taking great steps to improve our informal information sharing efforts and protocols, we're still seeing an explosion in MLAT requests. And so support for perhaps our Office of International Affairs in that effort. Congress working with us.
Thank you. My time has expired. Let me just ask the other witnesses to respond to the same question, if you will, for the record.
For the record. Yeah,
for the record,
so
please.
We can have other thank senators.
You. And thank you for that response.
Thanks, Senator Carper. Senator Booker.
Thank you, Chairman. And I want to thank the Chairman and the Ranking Member for working with my team in hosting this very important hearing. I'm grateful for it. I want to thank the panel for your extraordinary service to our country. Your dedication and your leadership is essential to our safety and security as a nation. It's clear, as was stated already by the Chairman and Ranking Member, that the scale differences in the challenges and threats are between the northern and southern border. It's just not the same scale on the northern border, and we understand that. This committee has held numerous hearings that have tended to focus on the southern border. I'm happy that we're having one here because there are still, as you all have enumerated in your various written testimonies, there are still tremendous threats along our northern border. And the fact that it is so porous, and I asked for that picture to be put up there, this vast over 5,000-mile border with incredibly diverse terrain, has areas that are tremendously porous, as this picture right here demonstrates how easy it is to cross undetected, really illustrate the need for the urgency for a threat. Now, I, for one, obviously am not calling for any fence, but also what I'm really looking for is a proportionate focus on our northern border threats. And Mr. Hartounian, you illustrated a lot of the terrorist nature of these threats, whether it's the recent train incident. We can go back to numerous ones. 1997, Ghazi Ibrahim Abu Mazir was convicted of conspiring to detonate a bomb in the New York City subway station. 1999, the millennial bomber Ahmed Rassam was stopped at Port Angeles, Washington, with components to be used to produce a bomb. The list, as you all know, as well as I do, of terrorist threats and incursions from the northern border are real, are substantive, and should be taken seriously. And so we have a tremendous cooperation, and I've been grateful for our Canadian, northern Canadian borders. Our governments really work well together. But I'm also concerned that cooperation is not going as far as it could be. For example, Canada does not share its no-fly list information with us, which to me raises some concerns for people that they've put on their no-fly list. So I just want to maybe ask that question specifically about the no-fly list. What efforts are we taking to obtain that information from Canada and to ensure the safety and protection of Americans from terrorists who may try to enter our country across that northern border? And that can be answered by anyone.
Well, Senator, I can't speak to that issue directly, but I can tell you your point is well taken, and that is public safety and the threat of terrorism, that's our number one priority. We ought to be mindful of that. We're very concerned about it every day. And to address it, I think we've been working closely with the Canadians. And one of the things that we've been doing is to integrate more closely with the Canadian prosecution teams. And we've been talking to them more frequently, meeting with them, and sharing information, not just between the agencies, but with the agents and with the prosecutors. So it's a very important point that you make.
But wouldn't that list, just knowing who they've put on a list to stop them from flying, seems like something that would be common sense to share with us of the people that they might have concerns about?
Yeah, I'm Senator, not really familiar with their position on that, but I will tell you that that in the realm of criminal cases and criminal work, we've had good luck with interaction and sharing.
Mr. Fisher, do you know about that issue, about the sharing of that information?
With respect, Senator, I believe John Wagner is prepared to answer that question.
Thank you, Mr. Wagner.
Thank you, Senator. I mean, the FBI owns the watch list for the U.S. government. And, I mean, as users of that watch list or any other information they could glean from other countries, we certainly, as the operator, we would welcome that information. Now, we do have a fairly robust sharing procedures with our counterparts in Canada, the CBSA, the Canada Border Services Agency. We have officers embedded at each of our different targeting centers where we go through airline reservation data and airline manifest to identify national security threats, and we have protocols to exchange information in cases when we see that. Now, most of the watch-listed individuals we see traveling are through commercial aviation still. The preponderance of watch-listed individuals is still coming via commercial aviation. And, you know, we've seen the incidents over the past number of years, focused primarily on commercial aviation between the underwear bomber, the shoe bomber, et cetera. We do see a couple of hundred a year, though, cross through the northern border as well.
And is the Canadians is forthcoming with their watch list? Or are we not getting that information? Because, again, not only do we have a northern border issue, and again, proportionality between the southern border, but 40% of our so-called undocumented immigrants are coming from airplanes, airports, overstays on visas in general. So I would think that would be important information to share.
Yes, so we set protocols to exchange when each of us identify a threat through our commercial aviation targeting. We have the protocols established to exchange that information and request additional information from each other to do that. And that's where we have our liaisons situated and physically present at each of our different targeting centers to be able to facilitate that exchange of that information. We also do a lot of what we call rule sharing or joint rule creation, where as we sift through the reservation data and the airline information, we create rules on what we're looking for, what we would consider to be activity we want to look closer at. And we sit down with the Canadian government, actually come up with joint rules between the two of us so we can really go through a North American approach on how we do that.
Great. Just because I have limited time, and I'm going to submit records I have, questions I have for the CBP regarding sort of racial profiling specifically, excessive force issues, which it looks like I won't have time to ask here, but I'd like to submit them and get those responses. But the last question I really want to ask is just, again, the resources we're applying to the challenges. And you all, again, are exhibiting extraordinary leadership and commitment, and our Canadian partners, extraordinary partnership. The Canadians should be praised. But I just really am concerned about the personnel challenges, including only 2,093 border agents stationed on the northern border compared to the 18,000, again, understandably on the southwest border with the size of that challenge. But that really means that only about 2,000 border agents are responsible for roughly 300,000 people that cross the U.S.-Canadian border each day. Do you all share my concern that we need more resources targeting the security of the northern border, given the vastness of the terrain and the large amounts of people that are coming through? Just in general, are we resource short on our northern border?
Yes, and we've articulated those needs in the administration's, you know, 15 and 16 budget requests. It's through a workload staffing model that measures the activity, at least at the ports of entry and the workload and the volume, and attributes a staffing number to be able to accomplish that. So we're happy to follow up afterwards on how that methodology works and what those numbers are.
Thank you.
And if I may, Senator, one of the things that that Homeland Security investigations are looking at is that when there are plus-ups along either the southwest border or the northern border from either our sister agencies and our counterparts in Office of Field Operations at the port or between the ports under Chief Fisher, a plus-up in CBP Border Patrol or inspectors is logically going to result in more interdictions, which could also result in more referrals for the need for investigators and more investigative work. So we would ask that the committee, and it wouldn't just affect us, because as we undertake more border-related or transnational criminal organization-related investigations, well, then that would affect Mr. Hartounian and the DOJ prosecutorial resources as well. So we would ask the committee to look at it as integrated agencies, how each one affects the other.
Thanks, Senator Booker. Senator Sass.
Thank you, Chairman Johnson and Senator Carper, for hosting this hearing. Thank you to all of you for making time for us. Chief Fisher, I'd like to talk about the term operational control. In 2011, the GAO found that CBP had operational control of 32 miles of the Canadian border. We've since abandoned that definition. I wonder if you can explain what operational control meant then, why we abandoned it, and if we had the same metric today, would we be at 32 miles or would we be in a lot healthier place?
Thank you, Senator. That's an excellent question. First of all, operational control was defined back in 2004 in our previous strategy as the extent to which we were able to identify, develop, and track and bring to a law enforcement resolution all entries along the border. The fundamental premise within the 2004 strategy was predicated on deterrence, right? So you wanted to prevent the entry in the first instance all across the board. And so when we started getting additional technology like border mile fence, which, by the way, we measured in a linear fashion, and we started deploying Border Patrol agents in the same manner and technology in the same manner, operational control as a default equaled the amount of technology deployments that we were doing. In other words, if you had 5 more miles of fence and cameras, it was acceptable based on our internal definitions of the levels of control to be able to count that as operational control. The difficulty came in two different areas. First and foremost is we were actually measuring the inputs. We weren't necessarily measuring the outcomes as a result of those deployments. And secondly, at some point in time, which it did, those resourcing capabilities run out. And so we could not, as an organization, then come back to this committee or others and say, well, we can't gain any more operational control based on our definitions unless you give us more stuff. And so we abandoned it because it didn't measure what we needed it to measure, and we switched to a risk-based approach to then take a look at measuring the probability of individuals coming across the border versus just the mere possibility, which the previous strategy was predicated to be able to secure the border in that fashion.
If we had a lot more than 6 minutes, I'd want to unpack whether or not the last point you made, which I completely concur with, that we want a risk-based approach, whether or not that's really reconcilable with, it sounds like you're saying we have a kind of baseline budgeting approach around here. Many of us are new, and so Gary Peters and I can ask new guy questions. Whether or not really you think that the threats are driving your budget requests, or whether or not a year over year, what would the Congress tolerate is what drives the request. And I think that Senator Booker asks a lot of great questions about the relative threats between northern and southern border, and I wonder if that's a place to pivot to the radiological concerns. In 2009, Secretary Napolitano testified that DHS had deployed radiation detection equipment across all northern ports of entry. Yet 2 years later, in 2011, the same GAO report found that it wouldn't be difficult at all to get nuclear material across the northern ports. I wonder if DHS is still using the same equipment. I wonder if that technology should be called a failure from that point because of the experience of 2009 to 2011, and if better technology exists today, is that something you're requesting of us?
Senator, again, I would defer an answer to that question from John Wagner, who's responsible for the port of entry operations.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Yes, but that equipment's still in place, and we're working with the Domestic Nuclear Detection Office as part of DHS to look at the recapitalization of that and what's the right equipment to purchase and design and build and deploy to be able to do that. We're looking at, you know, the calibration settings of the equipment, reducing what we call the nuisance alarms, to really to better focus on what the threats are and what our operational protocols in response to them are.
And so what would you say to the GAO 2011 report that it would be easy, or not difficult, I think was their term, to get nuclear material across the northern border, and is that the case today as well?
I don't necessarily agree with that.
What would give you comfort?
The equipment functions as it was designed to do. It looks at, you know, it looks at detecting what it was designed to do. So I'm not familiar offhand with the report or how they drew that conclusion to say it would be easy to do, whether it would be open or concealed or how it would be detected. I'll really have to go back and look at that.
Okay, I think we'll follow up with a formal question on that as well. When you think about the sources of Canadian threat, one way to think about the problem is what can we deter at the border? Another is the nature of potential terrorist threats originating in Canada changing? So you could have illegal immigration into Canada, you could have legal immigration into Canada, and you could have homegrown terrorist threats inside Canada. After the Ottawa attacks, the Canadian government said that they thought homegrown terrorism in Canada was a real and potentially prevalent problem. How do we respond strategically after the Ottawa threats and potential threats in the future if there were another instance of domestic terrorism inside Canada? Strategically, inside DHS, where would that threat be assessed and how would it change our behavior?
Well, Senator, in my experience, as the department has matured since 2003, what we have heard so far this morning in terms of integrated planning and execution, sharing of intelligence and information, the more as time goes on, the more dependent all of us are fighting the same fight are on each other to be able to do this. No component within the Department of Homeland Security owns the corner market on protecting America. We are so dependent, and each and every day it becomes clearer when John and I sit up and we get our intelligence briefing every morning about the evolving threat. And that's a really key thing to as a takeaway. This threat changes all the time. And we have to be able to be as responsive and perhaps more predictive as we start seeing those changes, which is the reason why a couple of years ago, CBP transitioned into integrated counter-network operations as a strategic philosophy, which basically means we're not just going to put Border Patrol agents every 25 meters and fence behind or in front of them and then cameras behind them, and we're going to try to deter somebody from coming across. Pragmatically, again, in my 28 years experience, that does not work for a couple of reasons. One, as a strategic objective, if you have deterrence as a goal, one, you are always going to fail because somebody will always come through. And number two, it is very difficult to measure. So if you're trying to figure out if you're deterring more people this year than last year, it gets very difficult to really understand. You get, at least I get mired up in all the statistics to try to understand whether, in fact, we're winning. And so when we look at the intent and capability which defines the threat of those adversaries, be them transnational criminal organizations or terrorism, or as a 2011 strategy to combat transnational organized crime introduced the convergence of TCOs and terrorism. Those are the things that our organization within the Department of Homeland Security is trying to get better each and every day.
Thank you. We're at my time, but I'll follow up with some more strategic questions by letter. Thanks.
Thank you, Senator Sass. Senator Peters.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for hosting this hearing, which is so important for the northern border, along with Ranking Member Carper. And being from Michigan, we are at the center of an awful lot of trade between Canada and transactions across our borders. And in fact, if you look at the volume of trade that goes across ports of entry of the top five in the country, Detroit's number two and Port Huron is number four. So we are definitely the tip of the spear, so to speak, when it comes to border control. And so it's a very important issue for my state as well as for the industry. And that's why I certainly want to thank Senator Johnson for his co-sponsorship of the amendment that I put forward in the recent budget bill to make sure that we're fully funding our ports of entry to make sure that they have the security that they need and the ability to process trade and travel efficiently. And that's why I'm going to make a brief pitch to make sure that we continue to get funding for the international border crossing, particularly with our new bridge that we are constructing between Detroit and Windsor and Port Huron. Port Huron does a great deal of traffic. They have been promised improvements in that customs plaza, which have not occurred, and we need to have those, and it's vitally important to our economy. And I want to thank all of the panelists here. This is an interesting hearing, and you have a extremely difficult job in the fact that you really have dual purposes, particularly when I look at my border crossings in Michigan. We are asking you to keep us safe, and we are also asking you not to delay us while we cross the border so that we can move trucks for just-in-time delivery for our manufacturing facilities, which rely on that. We have substantial agricultural interest that crops on those trucks that can't rot. They have to go across very expeditiously in order to get to the markets. And so that is a conflicting role, one that you do well, but we're asking you to do even more when it comes to moving traffic more efficiently. So I want to ask Mr. Fisher and Mr. Wagner, you've mentioned in your testimony a number of things that are happening to expedite some of the movement of goods in trade. What is working, and what is it that you need for you to do your job of protecting us while also making sure we can make sure trade is moving efficiently?
Thank you. And it's a couple of programs that we have that we really need to push and further get participation in. In the trade environment, it's our trusted trader programs. It's linking it to the Canadian programs. It's getting more companies and more businesses and more trucking companies enrolled in them. But it's also building the infrastructure then to support the crossings and allowing us to deliver on the promise that we can expedite those low risks or secure supply chains. And it just can't be over, say, the bridge structure or through the border crossing. You have to have the resulting highways to feed into that, to support that. So it's getting a higher percentage of transactions into those programs. On the traveler environment, it's the Nexus program. It's getting more travelers into those Nexus lanes, getting pre-approved so you can go back and forth much easier. It's less time we spend on these enrolled populations, as we call them, allows us to better focus on everyone else. So getting those percentages up, but also having the infrastructure to support and allowing us to then deliver on the promise that we make them of this facilitated or expedited crossing to do that. And then it's working closely with the Canadian government, looking at ways to increase the use of facilitative technology, most notably like the RFID-enabled traveler documents. Looking at, can we get a higher saturation of those types of documents, because those save us time at the border. They save us resources because we don't have to physically handle the card and read it through the reader. It reads automatically. We've seen great strides on the U.S.-Mexico border by getting a higher saturation of RFID-enabled lanes. It allows us to then do the watch list queries automatically as the car pulls up. And then building the infrastructure and segregating the traffic according to risk and or facilitative technology, you know, just like the toll booths do with Easy Pass, Exact Change, and everyone else. We have the Nexus is the Easy Pass lane, or the Sentry is the Easy Pass lane. The Exact Change is something we call the Ready lane, and that's somebody with an RFID document, but not necessarily vetted and pre-approved, like the Trusted Traveler program of Nexus or Sentry. And then everybody else goes over to the side, and they might be a longer wait there because of we know less about them, or they have a travel document doesn't allow us to facilitate the crossing. So it's really just pushing that and getting more people enrolled in them, and then the infrastructure to support it.
Well, we continue to have delays both in Port Huron and Detroit, and I know you're making great strides to expedite that. And it costs money. It costs a lot of money with the delays based on how the system works now. Are there additional resources that you need, or is it just a matter of time to implement these systems?
It's additional resources also. Like I mentioned earlier, we have a workload staffing model that takes all of the activity an officer does at a port of entry, takes the average time it takes to do it, takes how many times a day it's typically done, and comes up with the amount of hours to run a port of entry and divide that by the available work hours of an officer, and we come up with the staffing number of what we need to run based on the workload for that port of entry. Now, we can mitigate that need for new staff by some of our business transformation improvements that we make. So things like one of our current efforts is, you know, the trucks pull up and are still paying cash, you know, a couple of dollars and change to pay the user fees to cross the border rather than buying the decal. So we're looking at ways, could they pay that in advance online so we're not collecting cash in that primary booth and making change to deliver back to them? And the resulting savings and the workload savings and the time saving, that translates into staff at some point. And then the facilities piece, we recognize facilities are extremely expensive, just between the facility itself, the staffing, the equipment needed, and then the highways to connect it. So a lot of coordination needed, a lot of, we'd like to see a lot of regional planning to look at crossings as a systems of crossings rather than individual bridges or tunnels or crossings that sometimes compete with each other for traffic and for toll revenue. We really like to see regional planning efforts that take them as a system of crossings, working with our Canadian counterparts to move that traffic north and south on both borders.
Great. And I'm running out of time, Mr. Chairman, but I do have questions also related to racial profiling and the Justice Department's exemptions of the CBP for racial profiling, and with some of the Border Patrol's activities in Michigan as well that a number of my constituents have raised. So I will do that in writing, and I look forward to your response to some very serious concerns that have been raised to me, and I would like to hear your response. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Peters. Senator McCain.
I thank the witnesses for being here. Chief Fisher, last month, Congressman Salmon and I introduced legislation that would provide Border Patrol with access to federal lands to conduct routine patrols and install needed surveillance equipment to detect illegal entries across the border. The GAO testified that Border Patrol's access to some federal lands has been limited because of certain land management laws. For example, the Oregon Pipe National Monument, they did not approve, the land manager did not approve of the Border Patrol's request or plan to install detection equipment, in this case a tower. But we see this time after time, where the land manager is making the final decision on the installation of this equipment as opposed to the Border Patrol. Can you explain to me why that should be? One, if it's true, and two, why that should be.
Well, Senator, I don't know for a fact that is true. I'm not going to dispute your report and what GA may have found. I can imagine in some locations along all of public land, there are decisions that are made within the Department of the Interior, Fish and Wildlife, that perhaps are antithetical to the policies and or the approach that we would take in terms of the border.
Well, then it seems to me there should be a clear definition of who the final decision maker would be, which it seems to me should be your organization, not the land manager. During a hearing, Chief Fisher, month ago, General Kelly, who's the commander of the U.S. Southern Command, issued a warning about the threat that budget sequestration poses to security along our southern border. General Kelly warned that the potential threat of terrorists crossing our southern border, quote, is extremely serious, and called the budget cuts under sequestration a catastrophe which could effectively put me out of business. Mr. Wagner and Chief Fisher, do you agree with General Kelly's assessment of the effect of sequestration on your ability to control our borders?
Senator, I would agree with the General's assessment in terms of how the assessed threat is really serious in terms of identifying risk along our border. I think that is accurate.
How about being able to carry out your duties?
There are challenges.
Under sequestration.
Yes, sir. There are challenges each and every budget cycle with or without sequestration. We have finite resources.
So it doesn't matter to you?
No, sir. It does matter to me.
Then tell me, then for the record, tell us whether it matters or not.
Senator, it does matter. Yes, thank you.
And how serious is the impact?
At times, it can be very serious.
Thank you, Mr. Wagner.
I concur with the chief. It's something we manage through. It's an additional challenge that can be distracting from the mission. It can have detriment.
So you can just manage through it, right?
We manage. Well, we have to. We have no other choice.
Well, I don't know what. Am I not making myself clear? I want to know the effect of sequestration of your ability to do your job.
It makes it more difficult.
How much more difficult?
The entire process, getting a budget 6 months into a fiscal year, makes it more difficult. Looking at cuts arbitrarily across the board makes it more difficult. But
how about your ability to secure our borders?
We do the best we have with the process
I'm
that we go through.
I'm asking how it affects your ability to enforce our borders. What's the matter with you today? This is a pretty straightforward question. I want to know what sequestration, how it affects your ability to enforce our borders.
I said it makes it more difficult and more challenging. I don't have a number that I can put on.
Okay. Chief Fisher, General Kelly also said, and I quote, terrorist organizations could seek to leverage those same smuggling routes to move operatives with intent to cause grave harm to our citizens or even bring weapons of mass destruction into the United States. That's General Kelly, the commander of Southern Command's testimony last month before the Armed Services Committee. Do you share that view?
Yes, Senator, I do.
Would you elaborate?
Yes, Senator. I had mentioned earlier in terms of the 2011 strategy to combat transnational criminal organizations, and in particular the convergence, wherein that strategy looked at the possibility of organized crime and terrorism basically coming together to be able to exploit vulnerabilities along our border and other areas as well. And we see that as an emerging threat. That's our shift to taking a look at risk and risk mitigation, as opposed to just putting Border Patrol agents in fence everywhere, was the reason for that as well.
Are you seeing apprehending people coming across, particularly our southern border, but also our northern border, that are not from the traditional countries that we usually see immigrants? I'm talking about Mexico, Central America. Are you seeing people coming from many other parts of the world that you're apprehending?
Yes, Senator. On average, over the past 3 years along the southern border in particular, just because of the volume, we see individuals that are represented from over 140 different countries.
140 different countries?
Yes, Senator.
And could you give us some examples of that kind of surprise would surprise the average citizen?
Although the vast majority is still with the contiguous countries of Mexico, obviously on the southern border, Central and South America, I think we saw some of that increased activity predominantly from countries like Guatemala, El Salvador, and Honduras in particular.
Chinese?
I beg your pardon?
Have you seen Chinese come across the border?
Yes, sir.
Africa, sub-Saharan Africa?
Yes, sir. North Africa, like I said, I have the list of 144. I don't have them with me right now, sir.
Would you please submit that to the record and the numbers of those from these? A part of this, obviously, is international human smuggling operations, but also it could be disturbing to all of us to see how far away many of these illegal immigrants are coming across the border. Obviously, does that concern you as well?
It does, Senator. I'd be happy to provide that list to you.
Thank you. Finally, Mr. Chairman, are you expecting another large number of children showing up on our border, on our southern border in the next couple of months?
Senator, I'm confident at this point that based on where we are halfway through this year, that we will not see the level of unaccompanied children and levels of family units that we saw last year.
But you will see a significant number.
Again, if you're defining significant as if you compare that to 2010 and 2011, it will be up above those levels, but it is going to be down over the preceding 2 years.
I thank the witnesses. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, Senator McCain. Senator Ernst.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Gentlemen, I appreciate you being here today, and thanks for your service in protecting our great country. Today, we've heard a lot of testimony about shared efforts between Canada and the United States, and I do believe that they are a strong partner for us. I know Senator Booker had mentioned, you know, sharing the no-fly list information. That would be very important. But are there any other specific initiatives that we need to look at as far as joint activities with Canada? Anything that in your mind, and maybe Chief Fisher, if you could address this, or Mr. Wagner, but specific initiatives that we really do need to take a hard look at and implement?
Yes, Senator. I would say I briefly mentioned the IBET teams, where we're working very closely, embedded in many cases physically in space where we can share information. And equally important, not just the sharing of the information, is then being able to figure out what we collectively are going to do about that information on a particular threat. And if you take a look at the two countries and the different jurisdictional authorities and associated authorities that go with that, we are a lot stronger in doing that. And to the extent that we can expand not just the concept, but those teams and some of these regional concepts, I think we will be better for doing just that.
And it's continuing to work with our CBSA and other colleagues in Canada as they develop additional targeting and information sharing systems. You know, they're working on a system much like our ESTA system for visa waiver travelers, or pre-approval of that, and working with Canada to build a similar system, really, so we have a North American approach and consistent targeting and identification of national security factors, and then sharing and exchanging the ways and the protocols on how we can address those at the earliest possible opportunity.
Okay. Yes, go ahead, Mr. Spiro.
Thank you, Senator. Just to expand on Chief Fisher and Commissioner Wagner's answer, one of the things that I'd like to call attention to is, you know, we had talked about, and I believe it was Mr. Artunian who talked about a lot of the leadership committees and collaboration that's going on, whether it's the Beyond the Border Executive Group or the Cross Border Crime Forum or BOLT. Those are, as I said before, very, you know, those are good, great ways for us to strategize, identify the threats, both, you know, with interacting with our Canadian partners. But one of the things I want to expand on what Chief Fisher said was, in addition to the IBETs, our HSI Border Enforcement Security Task Forces are doing they're making a big difference. And one of they're the operators on the ground who are actually out doing conducting the investigations, making the search warrants on both sides of the border, and making the arrests and identifying and disrupting and dismantling the transnational criminal organizations. It's a great model. It's a model where we're allowed to, or we give our Title 19 cross-designation, or essentially deputized Canadian law enforcement, local Canadian law enforcement, as customs officers. And that way they can come into the United States and actually conduct side by side with us joint investigations under our close supervision, but to have that connectivity, investigator to investigator, agent to agent, coordination, collaboration, and just working the cases together, it is proven to be a very successful model.
Okay, and these are all initiatives that Canada is open to, and they are working well with the United States. Is that a correct assessment then?
Yes, Senator, they are.
Okay. Are there any? Yes, sir. Go ahead, please.
I'd just like to highlight some of the other work that's going on in the Pacific Northwest, specifically Operation Shiprider. Basically, it's an RCMP, U.S. Coast Guard initiative, in which different officers are cross-designated to operate in each other's waters. I also wanted to highlight the fact that the state of Washington and the province of BC do a yearly meeting with their law enforcement and trade representatives to share issues, problems, and resolutions on our cross-border trafficking. And so I think those are unique to how we operate. We also engage in a mutual discussions with them on a quarterly basis in our joint management team, which has the oversight of the BEST and the IBET programs. And we have a yearly meeting coming up. It's called Project North Star in Spokane, in which we will, again, sit down with our Canadian colleagues, as well as our state and local officials and federal agencies, again, to strategize and to implement those strategies in the near future.
That's great. I appreciate the collaboration that we have with our neighbors to the north. Through this process, have you seen any joint initiatives where the Canadians have actually pushed back, or they don't wish to collaborate with U.S. authorities? Are there any of those instances out there? Anybody? None that you've experienced?
No, I would say the only reticence sometimes is on sharing of targeting information. They have certain privacy rules which they have to abide by, and so sometimes that can be a little bit difficult. I think we talked about the MLATs and the information that's provided via that type of format. But I think those are overcome in the field on with operational matters and between the different agencies.
Okay.
Senator, from a prosecutor's perspective, we've made great efforts and I think great strides to bring our prosecution teams together to address some of the challenges that we face when we do cross-border operations and investigations. Sometimes there can be challenges sharing information. We have to make sure we're in compliance with the rules of each country. Sometimes we have to make charging decisions. Who are we going to charge and in what jurisdiction are we going to charge them? And there are different considerations that come into play based upon the law of Canada or the law of the U.S. So I think we've come a long way in bringing our prosecution teams together, bringing the Canadian provincial prosecutors and federal crown prosecutors together with our U.S. attorneys to work some of those differences out.
That's very good. I appreciate it. It's good to know what works and then if there are challenges out there as well. Thank you, gentlemen. My time has expired.
Thank you, Chairman Johnson, for Mr. Chairman, for the introduction and for the opportunity to talk about a border that we don't talk a lot about in this committee, which is the northern border. And it is interesting Senator McCain's still here, because I think one of the challenges we have both on the north and on the south border is as we have put and deployed more resources at the points of entry, we have opened up rural America, whether it is on the northern border or the southern border, to mischief. Things that used to happen through the port of entry now could, in fact, are happening on the southern border in very remote locations, which creates huge disruption to local communities, to rural America. I recently hosted Ali Mayorkas, the Deputy Secretary, in North Dakota, and I want to applaud Blue and Green. We gave them a great look at how cooperation works in North Dakota. And your folks have been just absolutely fabulous on the northern border and cooperating with local law enforcement, cooperating with Canadian officials, cooperating with local chiefs and sheriffs. It's just, it's seamless, and the applause is all around, but there's challenges. In Minnesota, the challenges are wooded. In North Dakota, it's open prairie, miles and miles. I mean, if I took you up there, farmers are farming around the boundary posts. So this is not what you see typically on the southern border. One of the big challenges we have is getting staff in remote locations. And I think you both can say the challenge, I think we're down a number of custom and border protection officers in Pembina, and we continue to struggle to get border patrol to stay on the northern border. And so my question to you is, what are you doing within the Department of Homeland Security to secure additional incentives for workforce to stay on the northern border?
Thank you. So recently commissioned an internal work group to look at exactly that. We have a lot of places that are hard to fill and hard to retain staff at. So we're looking at what are the options at our disposal now as far as relocation incentives, retention bonuses, paid moves, promises of, you know, limited assignments there of a couple of years, and then looking at what's the right options to offer at the different
points. Are you meeting with any resistance internally in making pay adjustments or incentive adjustments to secure staff on the northern border?
No, we haven't. It's just a matter of finding the budget funds to do it and figuring out what's the right approach at each one of the
So once locations. Again, we're back to budget constraints giving us a less secure border, I think is the point Senator McCain was trying to get at.
Well, we've
submitted. I know you don't want to say that, but
No, I'm happy to say that.
Because, I mean, okay, we'd like it if you'd say
we've submitted the staffing needs, you know, as part of the annual budget for the last couple of years. We did receive 2,000 more CBP officers 2 years ago. We're in the process of hiring them, but the need still remains for 2,624 more. And it's just finding ways to pay for that, and these would be distributed in amongst with the workload staffing model to do that.
I think we would be foolish to say that lack of or that we can manage the borders, either the northern borders or the coastal borders, which we haven't yet talked about, or the southern land border without additional resources. Be it additional aircraft that can monitor the border, basically transport. Folks in North Dakota, we don't have any capacity for detention. And we have a huge number of what I would tell you are undocumented workers who are working in construction in North Dakota, who are pulled off roofs and pulled off construction projects only to be on those construction projects the next day. And so I understand the lack of capacity, but I also think that we have to be realistic about the squeeze that we're putting on rural borders. You know, we're trying to take care of it, whether it's San Diego or McAllen or El Paso. You know, we see the problems there, and we ignore Cochise County and Pembina, you know, and to the west. And so you guys have to help us work through this, because as we push the envelope and put more and more restraints on those border crossings, we're going to move the bad guys to rural America, whether it's on the southern border or the northern border. The other question that I just want to broach quickly, because I think the focus here is all people coming to this country, but we have a fair number of people who are crossing into Canada from this country, and that causes concern for Canadian officials. Mr. Wagner, I was interested in your exchange with Senator Booker, because it seemed like we were maybe two ships passing in the night. Do the Canadian officials not share their watch list with us?
I don't believe we get their actual watch list.
Why is that?
I don't know.
Okay. Is that because we won't give them ours, or is it because they have privacy regulations that we can't work through?
The FBI manages it for us, and we're users and consumers of it, and we contribute to it, but we're not the owners of that.
But what I heard all of you talking about is this extraordinary cooperation you get from the Canadian officials. Sometimes laws don't allow it to be seamless, but I can tell you, as a former Attorney General from my state, when we used to do intel briefings on the northern border with local law enforcement, whether it's break-ins, burglaries, drugs, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police were always at those events. And so I can tell you, locally, it works very well. And it sounds like you believe that it works pretty well, kind of country to country. If you were going to make any changes in that relationship, what would you recommend, any of you?
I mean, it's really strengthening the information exchange and the access to the information that you have internally within, you know, your organization or your country. You know, we exchange a lot of information with the Canadian government at the land border. Our entry records are serving as their exit records and vice versa, so we can start the exchange and the identification of who's overstaying, and we can also see then who left the country. In the commercial aviation environment, you know, we're doing joint rules creation and joint targeting efforts to look at, you know, threats to North America, not just necessarily the U.S. or Canada in between, but it's what access do they have to be able to then share with us, which brings up the watch list.
Are we sharing lists of folks who are on the list for deportation with the Canadian officials?
I'm not aware. I don't know.
Mr. Chairman, I'll submit some additional questions, but I do want to once again give you a high five for all the great work that's done in North Dakota with constraints on resources and for the extraordinary cross-border cooperation and local government cooperation. You guys are doing a great job up there. Your folks should make you proud.
Well, thanks, Senator Heidkamp. I wish I would have been here for your questioning, because I know this obviously affects your state quite a bit, you know, what's happening on the border. You know, Chief Fisher, I do want to go back a little bit to the question from Senator McCain in terms of what is going to happen this year with the unaccompanied children. We shouldn't be minimizing this. Yeah, it's down from last year, but last year was a humanitarian crisis. I don't know what you call, you know, 60% level or wherever. Where are we at in terms of, you know, the total number that have come compared to last year? We're somewhere around 60-70% of last year's problem, correct?
Well, Senator, just so I'm clear, it was not my intent to minimize that flow, what happened last year by any stretch. And just looking at it, because it's more of a statistical anomaly last year. For us, it's people coming across the border for a variety of reasons. And when we see what happened, for instance, last year in South Texas, what the Department of Homeland Security did this year. And by the way, I should also mention, each and every year over the last 3 years, we have seen increases from individuals from Central America coming between the ports of entry. What changed last year was not necessarily the seasonal trends. That continued almost exactly the way it has been over the years. What did change was the volume. And what we try to do, and what we did do with the Secretary's leadership, is start looking at, after July, when the numbers started going down, was really looking back and say, one, how can we be better prepared, not just to react to it, but really to better predict it. The other interesting, at least it was interesting for me to see, and how the Secretary approached this, is the Department of Homeland Security was one of three departments that had equities and jurisdictional authority to respond to this. When you take a look at Health and Human Services, that is a very big piece when it comes to unaccompanied children. You look at the Department of Justice in terms of not just the prosecution, but, you know, what do we do across the board between the three different departments. That, I think, was the first time in my experience where we started seeing peaks of volumes along the border.
But there was, you know, I just have to stop you, because you used the word, you know, that was a statistical anomaly. No, it was far more than a statistical anomaly. I mean, it was a humanitarian crisis.
I don't
disagree. And
it was
one that was fueled by the actions of this government, this administration. I mean, I don't have the chart here. We've used other hearings, but we have a chart that shows, you know, really the number of unaccompanied children coming from Central America declining at, I guess, called a manageable level. You know, I think under 10,000. Again, I don't know the exact numbers. I don't have the chart. But then that just, you had deferred action on childhood admissions, and that just shot up. I mean, it was cause and effect. It was very clear. And by the way, you know, in our trip down to McAllen, Texas, you know, I want to commend the Customs Border Patrol and the really tremendous effort that they put forward to address that humanitarian crisis, but it continues at a 60 or 70% level. It's still a problem. And, you know, just having met with General Kelly, and I don't want to put words into his mouth, but I think, you know, he's certainly confirming what is my sense, is that no matter what Deferred Action Childhood Admissions says, no matter what, you know, the deferred action on parents, you know, whatever, no matter what those memorandum, those executive actions say, it's what is the reality. And the reality is, if you're a parent or a child in Central America and you send your child or you come up and you get into America, bottom line is you're staying. That's what the coyotes are telling them. Even though we have a counter communications strategy to say, no, this doesn't apply to you, the reality is it does apply. And I have to admit, as I've delved into this problem, and I know you are custom and border protection, the conclusion I'm really coming to is you could almost be renamed custom and border processing. Because that's certainly what I saw in McAllen, Texas. And as long as we continue to apprehend these individuals, as long as we have these incentives for people to come into this country because they realize that they get here, they are going to be able to stay. As long as we detect them, apprehend them, and then process them with a notice to appear, and then disperse from around America into the shadows, we're going to continue to have that problem. So we need to recognize that reality, and we need to start addressing it. I guess this is a pretty good staff work here. They've given me my chart, which pretty well shows the reality of the situation. So this is far more than a statistical anomaly. This is something that our immigration laws, executive actions actually caused. And until we're willing to admit that reality, we're not going to stop it. We're going to continue to have this human crisis occurring. You know, maybe it's only 60 or 70% level, but it's still a humanitarian crisis from my standpoint. Do you want to respond to that at all? I mean, tell me if I'm wrong.
Well, Senator, I do want to thank you for complimenting the men and women in Rio Grande Valley and in the greater South Texas. I, too, have been down there and very proud of the work that they do each and every day to protect this country. Thank you, sir.
But, okay. I do want to really go get back to the northern border and the drug trafficking there because, again, if you really take a look at the root cause of so much of our border insecurity, it is the insatiable demand for drugs in this country and what that has spawned over the last 50, 60 years. Really, our demand has caused so much of this problem, so much of this crisis. So I want to get some kind of sense of what is happening on the northern border, where it is flowing. Listen, I go every year up fishing in Canada. I've gone through those ports of entry, you know, pretty calmly, a bunch of folks with fishing boats. But I also understand the how porous that border is as well. Just, you know, hop in a canoe and all of a sudden you're a camper and who knows what you're transporting. So understanding we don't have the statistics, which is part of the problem, by the way, in evaluating how to provide greater security at the border, we don't have the information. And there's a real disparity in information, whether Customs and Border Patrol or Protection is talking about a 70-75% apprehension rate versus agents on the ground saying it's only 30-40%. So I want to get, again, some sense what is happening on the northern border specifically, as best as people can tell. And I realize you don't have exact information, but is the drug smuggling, is the human trafficking, would the potential terrorists that we're concerned about, are they going to come through the ports of entry, or are they going to be coming through the areas in between the ports of entry? I mean, can anybody address that basic question? Mr. Spiro.
Yes, Senator, thank you. You know, from our investigations, and again, we get a lot of referrals. A lot of our casework does come from referrals from either the ports of entry, the OFO, or between the ports from the Border Patrol. But not all of our investigations are referrals. Some of them are from our own confidential informants or from other federal, state, and local partners. We understand that one day the vulnerability could be at the port. One of the ways that we look at national security is that it's our job to make sure that we're investigating criminal fraud cases when it comes to people either pretending or appearing to making themselves appear that they're eligible for an entry visa to come into the country, whether that's a student who's coming in under a different name or doesn't intend to go to school, or whether it's a worker who claims that they're going to be working at a particular job in a particular industry and had purchase that visa, or whether it's in the interior where the fraudsters are trying to go to one of our other sister agencies, Citizenship and Immigration Services, to obtain a permanent residence or maybe even eventual U.S. citizenship by any kind of fraud. So through our documented benefit fraud task forces, through our participations on the Joint Terrorism Task Forces, where we can bring HSI can bring our Title VIII civil immigration authority, our abilities to investigate fraud, or our Title 19 customs fraud. We're looking at all types of vulnerabilities. We're not just focusing on one. And so whether that's people who are flying directly into the country, right into the interior, but maybe on a fraudulent visa or applied for asylum with some sort of fraudulent application, that's a big vulnerability, and that's something that we take seriously. But also some of our other national security strategies are is to make sure that sensitive technologies we use our export enforcement and our counterproliferation program to make sure the sensitive technologies are not getting outside of the country.
Okay. Yes. Again, what I'm not hearing is some sense for how much of the problem is coming through ports of entry, and whether we have to beef up personnel or improve the fund them in a deficit neutral fashion, or whether they're coming in between the ports of entry. And how do we ever get that information? I realize it's not the volume, so we're not, I guess, calculating percent apprehensions or anything else. Chief Fisher, would it make sense to utilize what drone flights we have? Would it make sense to have what detection capabilities we do have? Would it make sense, based on the anecdotal arrest and apprehension rate, to do some level of statistical sampling, some kind of measurement to get some kind of information so that policymakers who are going to be tasked with allocating those scarce resources have some sense of where the problem does lie on the northern border? I mean, do you understand the issue, the information I'm looking for here in terms of where the problem lies and what we need to do to really assess the extent of it and direct proper solutions?
I believe I do, Senator. And one of the things that, and certainly with the sake of time, I'd offer up the briefing to you or your staff. As was mentioned earlier, it's not as simplistic just to say, well, it's just happening at the ports, or it's just happening at the metrics that we use in terms of between the ports of entries. There are 12, and we take a look at trends, not just on the southern border. We take a look on the northern border. And we get, for instance, with John's folks and try to figure out, say, for instance, in a place like Swanton. So what is the dynamic there in Swanton? What is the business model of the illicit networks that operate in Canada that are exploiting the U.S. border? That scenario in terms of that threat is likely to be different than Blaine, Washington, or in Detroit. And so for us to just, or at least for me, to simplistically say, well, it's just at the ports of entry, between the ports of entry, it really depends on the area of the border, and we do have methods to be able to inform our judgments on where those redeployments should go. And we'd be happy to sit down
all,
and explain
that. I'm not asking for simplicity here, because I realize it doesn't exist. This is incredibly complex, and it's sector by sector, and it's area by area, and state by state, and even beyond that. Again, I realize the Montana border is completely different than the canoe area, boundary water canoe area up in Minnesota and Lake Superior and Detroit. I mean, this is a vast, vast border, and all kinds of differences. So I guess what I'll ask you, let's do a briefing. I want to understand the complexity. I want to understand exactly what you do know about anecdotally. Where have we seen, have people loaded up canoes? Are they flying it in small planes? Are they catapulting drugs across the border like they do, or with cannon? It's unbelievable. As I've delved into this situation, the number of methods, the ability to avoid detection, the use of the drug cartels, blocking off the bridges to these kids so that they can funnel them and put pressure, overload the system over here so they can, divert Customs and Border Patrol so they can smuggle the drugs over someplace else. No, trust me, I understand the enormous complexity of the situation, but I don't have the information. Okay, I know it's complex, but I really don't know how complex. I'm not sure anybody does. But if we're gonna start crafting solutions to provide better border security, you know, we need to better understand the complexity of it. So again, I'd look forward to briefing.
Thank you.
I was kind of hoping Senator Ayotte wanted to come here and offer some questions. If she doesn't get here in time, let me first offer all of you the opportunity to make a final point. You know, this is something Senator Carper has done. I learned from it. Certainly, if I was a witness, I'd be sitting here going, I want to make this point. So here's your opportunity. Make that final point. If Senator Ayotte gets here, we'll let her question. Otherwise, we'll close out the hearing. Chief Fisher, we'll start with you.
Senator, thank you for the consideration and obviously the opportunity to be here today. It was brought up a couple of times this morning, alluding to some of the effectiveness reporting in terms of what my office reports versus what may have been in the recent past articulated specifically by Mr. Cabrera. I know there's been a lot of questions, and for the sake of brevity, let me just say this. One, I've seen what Mr. Cabrera mentioned in terms of a host of things, the effectiveness rate, what he is hearing, what the policy is based on presumably what I have directed to the workforce in the field, among other things. Let me state for the record that none of that is based on truth. It is true, however, that Mr. Cabrera is entitled to his opinion. He is not, however, entitled to his own set of facts. And I would, not now, but with your staff, be able to clear that and tell you, in fact, what the policy is by my handwriting, what the transition has been over the last couple of years, and what I expect from each and every Border Patrol agent in uniform as it relates to data integrity and reporting, if in fact there are any allegations of misconduct. But thank you again for the opportunity, okay. Senator.
No, I appreciate that. And again, I have a keen understanding how difficult it is to get this information. This isn't like a manufacturing setting where you can study it, it's all right there. This is enormously difficult, enormously complex. So we're just trying to wade through that and try as best as possible describe the reality and try and ascertain the truth here, knowing that you're never going to get the full reality, the full truth. So again, you know, we certainly do appreciate your service to the nation and you know, doing what you can to grapple with a very difficult situation. Deputy Commissioner Wagner.
Thank you. It's really just a recognition of some of the economic activity that crosses that northern border, what it means to the economy of the United States and to Canada. You know, looking at within the Office of Field Operations, we have a huge workload of not necessarily just enforcement work. You know, there's the regulatory functions, there's the, you know, the processing, like you mentioned, you know, but of the commercial vehicles that cross the border. We're welcoming our citizens home, welcoming visitors, tourists, business travelers into the U.S., ensuring their compliance with all the laws and regulations. But, you know, the majority of the transactions we do conduct, and remember, every truck, every piece of cargo, every person, every train, every boat, everything has to be seen by a CBP officer and admitted and released by a CBP officer. The great majority of those transactions are good law-abiding companies and good law-abiding citizens and visitors. And it's layering our enforcement processes on top of that without stopping or hindering that movement back and forth and really ferreting out those bad actors and bad things from coming in. And that's where we try to apply a really a dedicated and targeted effort based on intelligence, based on our analysis, based on our cooperation with our foreign partners and our partners within the governments at the federal, state, and local levels to be able to best do that so we don't stop that commerce, because that will be just as devastating as an attack.
I agree. Thank you, and thank you for your service. Special Agent Spiro.
Thank you, Senator. I guess for my final point, I would just like to add that, I understand your frustration with our ability to necessarily pin down exactly or identify exactly where the threats are, because from an Immigration Customs Enforcement or Homeland Security Investigations point of view, where our focus is to attack transnational criminal organizations, no matter what they're doing. Because what we're finding at HSI are these organizations are smuggling guns, drugs, people. weapons. It's the roots that we're trying to identify and attack, and the organizations. And that's why we feel like our illicit path attack strategy puts us on the right path. We're not focusing on the individual committing the crime. When we hit that, when we stop that seizure, we make that big seizure, or we get a referral. That's the beginning of the investigation for us. That's not the end. It doesn't stop there. And what our strategy is to attempt to identify the whole scope of these global organizations, whether it's terrorist organizations or other criminal organizations. So that's, reaching back and using that our international footprint to identify the bad actors or members of the organizations in the source countries, in those transit countries, here in the United States, if the United States is the ultimate destination country, but also working with our Canadian partners. We're kind of changing the way that we measure success. I understand that the old methods of straight indictments, convictions, and arrests and seizures, and comparing them to the previous years, or matching up with what the resources are, isn't necessarily the best way to determine success. So we're moving towards a model. We've implemented a model where we're looking at what are the cases that we're doing that are having the biggest impact on border security, public safety, and national security. So I want to thank you for holding this hearing and bringing the attention to the northern border, and certainly for giving me the opportunity to represent the men and women of Immigration Customs Enforcement and Homeland Security Investigations. I know that they're out there on every day trying to do the best they can to enforce the immigration and customs laws of the United States.
Well, we thank them, and we thank you for your service. Mr. Rodriguez.
Thank you, Senator. I just wanted to make a couple of notes from an operational perspective. Again, when we talked about additional resources for the northern border, I want to make sure we don't overlook our intelligence capabilities and the challenges that we face. And to that aspect, I think our most critical support that we provide our partners is with intel analyst support. And so I know we talked about agents, investigators, but I don't want to leave that component out as far as the need for intelligence analysts. They play a critical role in our investigations. Secondly, I just wanted to point out a few gaps that my partners wanted to make sure I mentioned, and that was radio interoperability along the border. It still continues to be a problem, especially in those remote areas that you're familiar with, as well as our radar coverage, especially in over the Cascades, where we have these deep canyons and we can't get radar to look down in there. And so that also is one of the gaps we still need to address. And finally, as far as looking at specifically drug trafficking organizations, we measure our success with the numbers that we dismantle and disrupt. And again, a third of our numbers are multinational poly-drug organizations that are impacting not only our southern border, but also the northern border, because we're seeing more and more of our southern border DTOs coming up. Mm-hmm. And again, as I mentioned, trafficking more meth and cocaine through the United States into Canada.
Now, they're businesses, and they're looking for additional product lines, they're looking for additional markets, and they're finding them, and they're growing, and they're metastasizing, and it's an enormous problem. I also want to comment on the radio inoperability, or what we hope is complete operability. Or interoperability, it's consistently mentioned us as a problem. It's probably not the sexiest technology here, but it's an incredibly important one. So we've definitely heard that message as well. So Mr. Hartanian.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would agree. We face all the threats that you've described, and it can be frustrating. Threats from potential terrorists, drug smugglers, alien smugglers, human traffickers, you name it, and those are the threats that we face. And I think we should think about it in terms of how we address those threats, and we do it in a couple of ways. First, we have to have really robust prosecution regimes, and I think our U.S. Attorney's offices along the northern border, I know them all, I know their offices, they work hard, they bring good cases, and now that we're staffing back up after some of the lean budget years that we experienced, I think that things are looking up, and the future is bright for us. Robust enforcement, certainly very important. The second thing that we need is close collaboration between our law enforcement agencies and with our Canadian counterparts. And we could use some assistance, perhaps, with some of our DOJ law enforcement agencies having resources to work within some of these task force formats, ATF and DEA in particular. But we have to work toward integration, I think, with our Canadian counterparts, and we're taking steps to get there. And then finally, as you described, and this was a very important point, we have to address some root causes. And I think we have to take a comprehensive approach to the drug problem that we have and to the crime problem that we have. And that means to do other things other than just prosecute and incarcerate people. We can't just do that. We have to take a more well-rounded approach. We have to spend effort on reentry and on prevention. And I think the Attorney General's Smart on Crime program is, I think, well-designed to take a comprehensive approach toward our crime problem. So thank you for the opportunity to be here today. I appreciate it.
Well, thank you. We're actually working on right now a field hearing on high levels of incarceration rates. We'll probably do that in Milwaukee. Somewhat talking about the issue you raised there. I did want to ask you a question, because coming as a district attorney in the northern border sector, when we were down in McAllen, we just did a Sunday just driving around with people off hours, and local law enforcement was telling me that the fight over prosecutorial jurisdiction isn't the fight that I would have expected. You know, normally I'm hearing people, they want the collar, they want to be able to prosecute that criminal. That's not the case in the southern border, because it's so expensive to prosecute and people's budgets are strained. Basically, they're fighting over not having to prosecute individuals, and as a result, we got, again, anecdotally, we were told that unless, for example, there's at least 500 pounds of marijuana, they just don't even bother the prosecution. Now, that's on the southern border. As long as you're district attorney on the northern border, what is the jurisdictional battles? What is the type of prosecutions, kind of threshold, the discretion that you use?
So we do have thresholds, and typically large drug quantities the larger drug quantities are prosecuted in federal court primarily. We work very closely with our local district attorneys, particularly along the northern border, the four-county border area in the Northern District of New York. And when we have a case that perhaps doesn't rise to the level of a federal prosecution, we'll consult with our state counterparts, and the case may end up being prosecuted in state court. I think we work collaboratively with them. I wouldn't say that there's a competition or a desire to hand cases off. My experience is that we work very well, that we have a particular interest and needs and priorities, and I think we can meld those together quite well.
I've got 4 minutes left to vote. You've already voted. So will you close out the hearing? Is that okie dokie? But I'm kind of a rookie here. Okay. Let me just say again, thank you all for the time you took. I read the testimony. It's all very thoughtful. I know there's a lot of work and detail that goes into it. So thank you for taking that time, taking your time here to come and testify. Your very thoughtful answers to our questions, and I want to thank all my colleagues. This is a very well attended hearing, which I think indicates really how importantly we view this problem. But it also speaks to the complexity. There's an awful lot of questions that need, at least some answers. And I know those answers are very difficult to get to. So again, I want to thank you, and I'll turn it over to our ranking member.
Thank you. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Ranking Member Carper.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all for hanging in here with us. We're at this point in time, the Finance Committee has been in a markup on we have called a business meeting, a markup on the trade legislation, Trans-Pacific Trade Partnership, Trade Promotion Authority. So I'm trying to be in two places at once, not doing it too well, and we're voting. So it's a full morning. I want to ask a question that goes back to something that I don't know, Chief, if you said it or Mr. Wagner said it, but somebody said it, and you mentioned Mr. Hartunian, it was you, Hartunian. But the matter of Native American lands was mentioned. That's actually on the border between our country and Canada. And we have a similar situation along the border with Mexico. And at times I've heard from the Mexican border that sometimes the drug smugglers human traffickers use that land as a conduit to get through and try to get the cooperation of the folks who own that and live on that land. Can whoever raised this, would you and others just chime in about how this is of interest to us on the north as well as on the southern border?
You go ahead.
Mr. Burrell?
Yes, Senator, thank you. There certainly are some complexities when conducting investigations of crime on the Native American reservations. One of the complexities, certainly on the northern border in the area of the Akwesasne Mohawk Indian Reservation that Mr. Hartunia and I share jurisdiction with, is just plain the geography, sir. It's tough terrain up there, and it's ripe for smugglers to exploit in all seasons. And then certainly you have that added the winter
I'm
months.
Sure you said this. Which country is it in?
The Akwesasne Indian Reservation actually has territory both on the Canadian side and on the U.S. side, and the geography itself poses a lot of challenges towards law enforcement. On top of the geography, and in addition to the geography, there is some political sensitivities with the native population wanting to maintain as much sovereignty as they can. So sometimes it's difficult for us to conduct. We have to overcome that challenge of gaining their trust. In some cases, it's a very close-knit, small population, and that again poses some issues or challenges for us that are somewhat unique. But on the other hand, one of the things that is getting better from our standpoint, and we're making a lot more progress, is our Messina Best up there. Our Messina Border Enforcement Security Task Force. Mm-hmm. We actually have the Akwesasne Mohawk Police Service representatives on that participate on the task force, as well as the St. Regis police officers on our task force. They have been, there are members that have been cross-designated with Title 19 authority, so essentially they're deputized customs agents, and they're working those cases with us to help reduce those vulnerabilities. In reality, we know all of the challenges I met. The smuggling organizations know what they are too, and they try and do their best to exploit everything. So we're trying to do a better job, with our outreach on the Indian reservation, our close coordination and collaboration with the Native police force, Native American police forces on that reservation, and working together to do everything we can to mitigate that threat, sir.
All right. Others on this point, please. Anybody? Chief, Mr. White, help. Let's go down to the southern border with Mexico. Do we have a similar situation in some areas along the southern border? And how do we figure out how to work with the Native Americans to be able to secure that portion of the border?
Yes, Senator, as described in the Akwesasne on the Tohono-O'odham Reservation on the southwest border, which the geography takes on the western portion in Arizona, both in Tucson and what we call the West Desert, that tribe does extend in the United States and into Mexico. And so part of when we look at the border in terms of trying to identify likely routes of entry over the years, as we have built both primary pedestrian fence and vehicle barricades, it's always challenging to try to work with the tribe, work with the leadership in the tribe, and letting them know if they will allow us to put some impediments along the border or bring infrastructure or technology to help increase our situational awareness. Early in those discussions years ago, it was very difficult to make the case until the infrastructure and technology started to manifest around the reservation, which obviously the path of least resistance came through the Tohono-O'odham Nation. Matter of fact, up until the middle of 2013, the vast majority of trafficking across the southern border came through Arizona, and the vast majority of that traffic came through the West Desert, through the nation. I think they realized the vulnerability, and we are working a lot better with them. As a matter of fact, we are currently in the process of developing integrated fixed towers. Now, the first phase of that as you well know, was in Nogales. In late summer, we're in the process going to transition into phase two, and we currently have authorization from the tribe to be able to move into deployment of integrated fixed towers to cover a vast region of that reservation. So that'll be, for us, something that's been a long time in coming, sir.
All right, thanks. Thanks very much. The last question that I'll present to all of you here today is goes back to something I oftentimes say, I like to say, find out what works, do more of that. Find out what doesn't work and do less of that. And that advice was actually presented to the Finance Committee a couple of years ago when I was serving on at a hearing and by Alan Blinder. Alan Blinder, when he was asked, what should we do on deficit reduction? What should we do on deficit reduction with respect to health care and reining in health care costs? And he said, I'm not an expert on this stuff. I'm not a health economist. Here's what I would do. Find out what works. Do more of that. And I said, you mean find out what doesn't work and do less of that? He said, yep. So with that spirit, that thought in mind, could y'all just take maybe a minute or so apiece and just talk to us again about what is working on the northern border that appears to be working, that is replicable, particularly along our southern border? Maybe you could each just pick one point, something that's working along the northern border that's worth replicating and could be exported to the southern border, and maybe some of the best practices from your experience or your observations on the northern border that we'd be smart to try on the southern border. And Mr. Artunian, you want to go?
Yes, thank you, Senator. Great question. What's working? Robust enforcement. And that's not to say that's not happening on the southern border. I think our U.S. Attorney's offices all along the border are working very hard. Their mm-hmm. people, their AUSAs are really working hard to get the job done. But it's certainly a critical component. I think what works on the northern border is close collaboration with the Canadians. And while that might be a bit more challenging in Mexico, I think it can be done. And close collaboration between the prosecutors of both nations. And that is something that we're seeing happen more and more. We're working to improve that, make that happen more frequently. And I think that that's an important approach that we can take. So I would highlight those two things.
Thank you, sir. Is one of the reasons why maybe we work better with the Canadians in terms of sharing information is we have less concerns about that information finding itself in the wrong hands in Canada?
Well, I think that there is cooperation with the Mexican authorities. I think in all cases we have to be careful how we share law enforcement information. That's certainly not a barrier that can't be overcome.
Okay, good. Thank you. Mr. Rodriguez, please.
All right. From my
You were in DEA for a while, weren't you, for a number of years?
For 27 years, Senator.
That's great. Thank you for that as well.
From my perspective, it's just not the one meeting, the one event, the one policy discussion. We have a number of conversations, both with our federal partners on the border, mm-hmm. as well as with Canadians, year-round. It could be case-specific, it could be program-specific, and if we have to, we then follow up on these discussions where we will put a working group together to work on maybe some shipwrighter issues or some intel issues that we need to look at specifically to MDMA or ecstasy. And so I think those are the best practices that work well for us on the northern border and that makes us unique and that we need to keep going and hopefully we can eventually have those types of processes in place on the southern border to help there.
All right, thanks. Mr. Spiro, same question, please.
Senator Carper, I appreciate the question. I actually had a little bit of extra time to formulate my answer. And I guess the best way for me to describe it or the way I look at it is that it's not necessarily how do we take what's working on the northern border and bring it down to the southern border, but it's an exchange of best practices across both borders as well as the interior of the United States. And I use the Border Enforcement Security Task Forces, or the BEST, as an example. BEST was originally created in Laredo in 2005 to combat the violence associated with the transnational criminal organizations that were affecting specifically the southern border. That model with the success of that model, with the collaboration and cooperation and working together on the cases, was then brought up to the northern border, and now we have four northern border best task forces. I happen to oversee two in my AOR of Buffalo, the Port of Buffalo best, as well as the Messina best. But at the same time, it doesn't just stop there. We don't bring what we've learned from the southwest border and bring it up to the northern border. We had a framework, a great framework to start with, but then we take that to the next level. Our abilities to expand those best. We actually have over 40. Just about 43 members now of our best team in Messina. Our abilities to incorporate our Canadian law enforcement counterparts at all levels, whether it's the RCMP and the CBSA, but the Sûreté du Québec or the regional police offices, and having as much, not just information sharing, because of course information sharing is extremely important, but we're able to actually take the information in those collaboration sessions and then and put them to use in our investigations. And that's how, you know, we complete that last piece of identifying, disrupting, and dismantling the transnational criminal organizations that are the biggest threats to the homeland.
Good, thank you. Ms. Wagner.
Senator, at the ports of entry, it's really, we focus on the risk segmentation of the workload and looking at ways, to better utilize the physical infrastructure that's there and getting the most efficiencies we can out of it. Now, how we define something as lower risk or higher risk is all dependent on what access to what systems we have, the analysis and the targeting capabilities. That's also enhanced by what our foreign partners are sharing with us. We have very good data exchange, information exchange with the Canadian government and the Mexican government. They have different capacities as to what access they can get, what information they collect, and then within their own privacy constraints, what they can share with us. But it's a little different within both countries, but we do have very robust information exchanges with the Mexican government as well as the Canadian government that helps us make that risk segmentation determination.
Great. Chief, my time's expired and my colleagues are back. Would you answer that question for me for the record, please?
Yes, Senator, you mentioned it briefly, I think, is the institutionalization of what we see in the northern border in terms of shared information, integrated planning and execution, which then you have a degree of sustainability in that effort. We can do a lot better on the southern border in that regard. Thank you, Senator.
Thank you very much, Chief. Thank you all. Great job.
Thanks for holding down the fort. I found somebody on the Senate floor there. Senator Ayotte.
Senate floor picking up senators. So thank you all for being here. I appreciate it. And, representing New Hampshire, northern border is pretty important to us. And I'm not sure if you've been asked this question yet, but one of the directors of National Intelligence, James Clapper, has identified drug trafficking, obviously, as a major transnational organized crime. In my state, we're seeing a heroin epidemic, and I know a lot of that's coming over the southern border. So what's the biggest issues that we're facing on the northern border, and how can you help me understand how's the information sharing with Canadian authorities? Because that's where my local law enforcement and my state police and even the federal officials that work in New Hampshire would be working with on the Canadian side. Whoever's best to take that question. Yeah.
Thank you, Senator. Specifics to heroin, you're right. We are seeing heroin that's coming up through Mexico, and the intelligence that we're developing from our ongoing criminal investigations and our closed investigations is that we're seeing either precursor chemicals or heroin coming from China. It's being imported into Mexico under the control of the cartels. The cartels are using the existing smuggling networks to get them into the United States through the southwest border. And whether those smuggling networks are, the smuggling networks are used by to smuggle anything. So whether it's people, or whether it's drugs. The cartels have control of the networks and the pathways, and they're using that to get heroin into the country for either ultimate consumption here in the United States, or in some cases on into Canada as well. And one of the things that we had we were talking about was our ability and our need to make sure that we do everything that we can across all levels of law enforcement, whether it's federal, state, or local law enforcement, or in my particular neck of the woods, even tribal law enforcement, and international law enforcement as well, particularly with our Canadian counterparts on the Canadian side of the border. Where we have the biggest issues in my particular AOR, the Messina or Rouses Point area, we use our border enforcement security task forces as a mechanism to share information back and forth with our Canadian counterparts. So we actually have cross-designated. We've given essentially Title 19 or Customs Authority, basically making state and local law enforcement designated customs officials, but also we're able to do that with Canadian local law enforcement officials as well. And then they can come and work the networks on this side of the border. So that the idea here is to open up information sharing, work the cases together, and instead of not only trying to remove the U.S.-Canadian border as a potential barrier to law enforcement, we're actually able to use it to our advantage. So we understand it's a problem. Heroin seems to be on the rise, but one of the things that we think is the best way to conduct to identify, disrupt, or dismantle these transnational criminal organizations, no matter what commodity they smuggle, whether it's heroin, whether it's cocaine, or whether it's marijuana, or firearms for that matter, is to identify the scope of the organization in the source countries, the transit countries, the destination countries, and work together with law enforcement at all levels to share the information and work the cases.
So I get all that, just thinking about how do we drive up the price of heroin? Because one of the problems we have right now with heroin is it's so cheap. Obviously, the more we can make it tougher for them to transport this stuff over, it's so cheap that some people are addicted to prescription drugs, they go over to heroin, and it's really fueling this huge public health epidemic, not just in New Hampshire, it's across this country. I mean, do we need to give you bigger tools? What do we need to give you to help you to drive up the price to really come down on the people transporting heroin?
One of the things that we look at in any of the drug trade, and whether it's the heroin, and I should have also mentioned before that one of the newer trends that we're seeing with respect to heroin is the heroin laced with the fentanyl, which would really be the deadliest part
of the drug. It's like heroin on steroids, basically.
Absolutely, ma'am. Almost as with any business model, I think that if we can be more effective at reducing the supply, then that would drive up that would be one way to drive up the price. Another thing that we're trying to do is with almost every enforcement program that we have at Homeland Security Investigations, there's also a public outreach or a public service announcement message that goes along with it. So if we do have a particularly big search warrant where there's a big seizure or a big arrest or a big sentence, we try and get out to the public that, hey, if it's the kids that are using the heroin laced with fentanyl, to get out there and say, look, you don't know what you're using, what the impacts are on you. So not only did we just conduct this investigation and make this arrest, but this is why it's important that you you don't use it because you don't.
Yeah, we've got to do a better job overall with that. I have a question about in terms of Canada, as I understand it right now, and I'm not sure whoever the best person to answer the question, I'll just feel it. Right now, as I understand it, Canada doesn't have a system in place to screen inbound airplane passengers against the terrorist watch list, and so they're moving toward the capability. Is this true? And if so, those on the terrorist watch list can presumably enter Canada on an airplane. Is that true? who knows about that, and can you help me understand that? Because I'm really worried about, you know, we've got these foreign fighters that have gone to obviously Syria, Iraq, Yemen. Some of them are Canadians. We've had some Americans too. But, you know, Canada's fairly, we have a great relationship with Canada. And so if you can get to Canada without getting through the watch list, it's really not that hard to get to the United States of America. So what are your thoughts on this problem?
I don't know if they have direct access to the U.S. government watch list and that they screen against that directly, but they have a similar system that we do of screening airline passengers against the airline reservation systems and the airline manifest before that person comes into that country. We work very closely with them, and we identify similar approaches to how we screen that. We call them rules, and we set rules against how we scrub that data and how we identify national security or any other types of concerns. We do joint rule creation, we do rules exchanges, and we have certain protocols in place that when certain rules fire, we'll exchange information and ask each other country about additional information.
Do you know if they have the equivalent of our terrorist watch list? What are they checking their passenger list against? Do you know the answer to that?
It's against their own systems and their own list. So they do, I believe, have a national security list. They have customs records. They have immigration lookouts. They have access to the Interpol laws.
So can I ask you a question? Just when you're thinking about a friendly neighbor like Canada, why couldn't we join forces on some of that in terms of terrorist watch list information? I know we do information sharing, but it seems to me that we've got if we can't trust the Canadians, we're in trouble. Any thoughts on that?
We don't own that information, so it really wouldn't be ours to exchange with them. But as consumers and users of it, we would certainly welcome access to any additional sources of information.
Maybe I'm asking that of the wrong person, but I think it's something I serve on the aviation. I'm the chairman of the aviation committee, and I think this is perhaps a question I should direct to TSA or something.
And just one final point. If somebody does fly into Canada and drive across the border, we run the same database checks and the same watch list checks at the land border as we do in commercial aviation. They're the same systems and the same databases
that we're checking. So you'd catch it there?
Correct.
Catch an individual there if they presumably were on our list, even if Canada didn't catch it?
Correct.
Okay, great, thanks.
Thanks, Senator. That is a really good point. I mean, my understanding is the same as yours, is that they are not using our watch list, and that's something I think we need to press to see what we can do to cooperate between the two governments. Correct. So again, thank you for coming. Again, thank you all for your time, your efforts, your testimony. This hearing record will remain open for 15 days until May 7th at 5 p.m. for the submission of statements and questions for the record. This hearing is adjourned.
Thanks, Ron.
I'm the leading state sponsor of terrorism.